goes. So thank you for showing up, everybody. Today we got a super great webinar. We have in the building, not necessarily in the building, but just on the webinar, we're going to have John Gill, ASM legend. He's going to come on here today and show us all that he knows about Alibaba, not just that, how he started, his tips and top tips and tactics, how to differentiate your product in Alibaba, how to just source from Alibaba. And then he's going to get into some more advanced tactics and show us exactly what he's doing right now. He's going to talk a little bit about the Canton Fair. He and I hold a mastermind every, they have two sessions, every session at the Canton Fair. And he's going to talk a little bit about that. And he's also going to come on here and give us a ninja tip at the end of this. So you guys should be really excited about that. Not only is his ninja tip great, but just his content overall is great. I cannot tell you all enough how much I've learned from the man. He's just absolutely incredible. And he's just a relentless businessman is about the best way I can actually describe him. John is constantly just, he's setting the bar to a higher level. He was actually one of the very first Amazon sellers that got into Vendor Central. So if you all have Vendor Central questions, I highly recommend you ask him. He knows more than anybody else that I know at Vendor Central. And just his Amazon knowledge is just, it's amazing how much knowledge he has on Amazon. As I said before, he's usually pioneering things. So he's always in the know and he knows exactly what's going on with Amazon. So you should be super excited. He's here to show us his best Alibaba tactics. And really overall, he's going to just give us lessons in business because, as I said before, he's a relentless businessman. He's actually got a business coach. He's trying to improve himself every day as a businessman. And I couldn't be happier to call somebody my friend as well as a business partner of mine and just an overall great guy. He's just a really good guy. So I'm excited that he's going to be here. We've also got on the call, as usual, Smack. So Smack, say hello to everybody. Everybody knows good old Smack. She is a really solid Amazon seller, and Smack's just typically in the know. Smack knows everything there is to know about Amazon, and she's certainly one of the first and foremost experts on the review process, so she's always is right here. Smack, say hello to everyone.
All I can say, Liz, is if people are playing the drinking game for every time you say Smack, we no longer have an audience.
We would all be passed out.
Great to be here. Great to be here today.
Let's be happy that we
don't. And I'm really excited and talking to John. Haven't seen him for a while.
Let's be happy that we don't take shots when I say Smack because, we'd be in a lot of trouble. So, good old Smack. Smack, you got a bunch of fans here. People always love to say things about Smack. And again, she's great. We're also going to have on the call, good old Mandy Payne, who is really one of the best people that I know in terms of picking products. And she's gotten really great at picking products, actually. I kind of have to take a little bit of credit for that, though. Mandy, are you there?
I am here. I'm currently picking products. So if you lose me, I'm busily picking products.
I got to say, I got to take a little bit of credit for that because I think I showed you a little bit about product selection. And you've actually gotten really good. A couple of the last products you sent over to me and suggested, I was like, wow, these are actually really good. In fact, a couple of them, I was sort of like drooling over them because of the fact that they were just so juicy. So I've got to give you a compliment on that. I think you've become an excellent product picker.
I do exactly what you tell me to do. If everyone does exactly what you tell them to do, they'll all be great product pickers.
Yeah.
Billionaires.
It's amazing. Mandy picked some excellent products, and I was super excited to actually put them into production. So big benefit to sort of like sharing what you know. And, of course, Mandy's a really great product selection person. That's primarily because she was at one point one of the top 10 Amazon reviewers, and she's probably – I mean, I don't think I know anybody that knows more about products than Mandy. I can ask her what are the certifications required for electronics or – what do the current Bluetooth floating speakers, what's so good about them? And really good at differentiating products and giving suggestions for that. And she also has a sourcing agency, which we'll talk about at the end of it. It's something that I use. I actually use this. I do all my sourcing is now outsourced. I no longer even bother with that. I still enjoy going to the Canton Fair, though, just because you never know what you run across there. And I also like going to some of the Asian expos. And just overall, like Iwu, I like to go just to China in general, just to check things out. I think it's a lot of fun. And I certainly tried to do my best to show people China first class, which, again, a lot of people, like including myself and some of the people that I originally used to go with, we didn't see China in first class. I got scammed by a cab one time. It happens to the best of us. I overpaid a cab. Luckily, I got to the hotel, and I've been scammed numerous amount of times. Some of those Chinese people are just straight up predators, so that was not fun. Luckily now, I get to show people China first class, and it's the way that I've finally gotten to know China after being there a total of 7 times. So it took a while to do that. Smack, do you remember your first trip to China? How was that? You went with our group, the Mastermind. How was that actual experience? Just to kind of let everybody know how China is before we get started here.
China was, it was absolutely incredible. I mean, walking into the Canton Fair and seeing all of the stuff there, I mean, it was like a little kid at Toys R Us at Christmas, but on steroids, because there are hundreds and hundreds of thousands of products. It really opened my eyes to the potential of the business. And it also surprised me how easy it was to forge solid relationships with my suppliers. You know, just like dealing with business people in the U.S. I mean, we're a lot more similar than we are different. So it was really, really an incredible experience for me.
Right. China is absolutely epic. And we'll get more into China and the Canton Fair so you guys know a little bit more about that. But first, I just wanted to do those intros for you. In a minute here, we're going to pull up John Gill. He says he's on, so he should be in here somewhere. I'm not sure if I see him yet. Let me see. Smack, do you see John here at all? Oh, I see him. Okay.
Okay.
Okay, so I'm adding John Gill here, guys. Just right, he should be coming on here in a minute. John, are you there?
I'm here. Can you hear me?
Awesome. Awesome, John. So I know everybody's excited to see you, hear you, I mean, and they're pumped to hear about a little bit about your story. But first, what I wanted to do to get started here is I wanted to talk a little bit to Mandy, especially if she's still there. We actually got lucky that Mandy wanted to come on here because she's such a busy lady that she's a difficult person to get a hold of. But Mandy, I wanted to first talk about you just from the perspective of you've been a top Amazon reviewer. Can you give everybody an idea of how many products a day you would actually get from people when you actually were reviewing products on Amazon?
There were days I would get most days I'd get at least 20 to 30 products in the mail. I'd come home and I couldn't get in my front door. The boxes would be piled so high. About 3 months before Christmas, it would turn into it would go from 30 to maybe 60 or 80 products a day. So I've had my hands on everything.
Right, and let me ask you another question. What do you think was the most common product you got a lot of? Like, what was a product that you got just a shit ton of?
Backup batteries, those external backup batteries for your cell phone and electronics.
And were those batteries, were they all, like, pretty much the same thing? Was there anything special about them, or was, for the most part, were you seeing a common theme that they were all pretty similar?
You know, they're different shapes and different milliamps, but I would say out of all of them, only one has ever stood out to me. So it's, yeah, they were all pretty much the same. Some had flashlights, some didn't, some had, you know, SOS signals. They tried everything to make them different, but there were so many of them that there's only so much you can do with a battery.
What was the one that stood out to you? I'm curious myself.
It was a backup battery that you plugged into your lighter, and it had two USB outlets, so you could use it as a car charger. It would charge the battery and your phone at the same time, and then you could leave with your, you know, how many times you're driving, you're like, oh, I'm not even close to charge, but I got to pull my phone out. Well, you could take your car charger with you and continue to charge your phone.
Wow, that sounds actually pretty cool.
I don't know how well they did, but it was awesome. That's the only one I can say really stood out.
Wow. For you, have you actually done a lot of searching on Alibaba? What do you think of Alibaba as a whole? Like, I mean, it's obviously very useful for somebody that cannot go to China or somebody that is just starting out. How do you find it in terms of for finding products?
I think Alibaba is great, and we actually, when we're sourcing, we use Alibaba because a lot of the, if not the factories, then the trading companies are there, and we can. It's a place to start. I think when you're on Alibaba, you'll notice that all of the pictures are the same. It'll say the same product, but very different prices, and it'll have the same pictures. So it's, I think it's a good place to start, and if you have a very small order and you're on a limited budget, you know, you take a risk with it, but hopefully it's a small risk because, you know, I've heard horror stories about Alibaba. But I do think that if you're very limited, then that's a good place to start.
Right. And I know there have been, you know, a good deal of horror stories, but at the same time, there's a lot of people get their start there and they find a pretty good vendor and they create some sort of relationship, at least to start. I know John, for one, did, and we'll get here in a little bit more into his story so he could tell us a little bit more about Alibaba. But Mandy, one more question for you, and then hopefully you hang out for at least a little bit just in case you have anything to add. At any time, feel free to jump on and let us know what you think about something we're talking about. But what tips, if any, do you have for people that are just starting and they're about to look into Alibaba? So it's actually a two-part question. The first one is, what tips do you have for people that are just getting started and are having to go with Alibaba because really right now this is their start and they have no choice?
Oh, my goodness. Well, I mean, it's hard to say exactly what I would tell them because Alibaba is such a risk. But I do think the vast majority of people who use it probably have good luck there. I would say go with your gut and really try to communicate a lot with your supplier there, because if they're not responsive or if you get sketchy responses or it seems too good to be true, you might end up finding out that it's too good to be true. You know, and if you have a large product, be very careful how much money you're sending and wiring and to whom. And what's the second part of the question?
Second,
I got distracted by a shiny object.
Second question is, I haven't said it, Mandy. I was trying to trick you. So second question is, if now you made me forget the second question. The second question.
Let's say Susan, because I need a shot.
Okay, let's see. Susan, are you? Let's get the shot. I got my coffee shots ready to go here. Okay, Susan. I mean, Mandy. Here's the second question. I remember now. The second question is, if knowing people have like a limited budget, and I know you've seen so many different products, what, if anything, do you recommend to help them sort of like stand out or make their product different? Is there any kind of like mini tips? I mean, do they just go with a different color, or what do you recommend they do just since you've seen so many different products? What are maybe a product that stood out to you that it was the same old shit, but they did something different that just kind of stuck out in your head and you're like, wow, this is a nice touch or something like that?
Well, if it's difficult on something like Alibaba to do much different with the actual product because you're buying what they have and you can't really make a lot of changes. Some will let you add logos and do different things, but you can't make big differences. But if you make even a minor addition, just add something that's an obvious addition but inexpensive to the product, like I'm trying to think of.
Like a bonus?
A case or a bonus or – and even if it's just – well, I mean, it boils down to your listing too so much, and that's your thing, but – but, I mean, on Alibaba, I would say have a really nice case or a really nice box, because when you're starting out and you're getting your initial reviews, you want your first impression to be a great one. And then you can make your changes after you've introduced a product and gone with a smaller number. Does that make
sense?
Can I comment
on that?
Susan, you cannot comment. I'm just kidding. Go right ahead.
That hasn't been my experience with working with the suppliers I met with Alibaba. And one of my qualifying conditions when I work with a supplier is asking for mold changes, because I do tend to spend more with mold changes. So, you know, I see you have this product here. I'm looking for something similar, but what I'd really like to do is this, this, and this. And can you do that?
Smack.
And the suppliers who are really manufacturers, you sort of start a business discussion with them. Like, I don't start saying, oh, this is a product I've seen, what's your price and what's your MOQ, that I start a discussion with them. And I've had, you know, mold changes, some of them fairly substantial, for each of the products that I purchased off a supplier that I met on Alibaba. So I don't really think of Alibaba the way I do AliExpress, where you're just going and buying products. I view Alibaba more as a supplier database, and what they're putting up there is an advertising about some things they may be able to do. Or I've been thinking of, you know, a product, and, you know, if it was some kind of a silicone kitchen product and there's another silicone manufacturer on Alibaba, I will ask them, hey, I didn't see this in your inventory, but can you do this? Smack. And I found, I think the reason Smack. That I've had success.
Hey, Smack, can you explain to everybody what a mold is? Because there's a lot of people that are brand new here that might.
Susan, can I just say one thing? I mean, I don't disagree with you. I was just going on the, if they're on a very limited budget, sometimes mold changes can be very expensive. So I'm not saying that you can't. You can get anything you want done in China if you're willing to pay for it. And through Alibaba, it's great. I don't disagree. I just wanted to say that I was answering on a, if I was starting and had a $3,000 budget and was going to Alibaba, you're not going to get a lot of changes with a very limited budget. But go ahead and talk about it. I mean,
I agree with that. The kinds of mold changes I've had, that I've paid for usually cost me between $800 and $1,200 on an order of 1,000. So it's going to add another, you know, piece to my first order. But I think in terms of talking about it and even having the discussion with the supplier about what they're willing to do, because there was one and the mold change was going to be $6,000. So I decided I'd go with what they have. But, having the discussion with them establishes your credibility with them. And also, you're able to learn a little bit about whether or not they are really into working a relationship. So the key, and a mold change is basically just a design change. They call it a mold change, and that's sort of weird because you sit there and say, gee, these are like paper stickers. How can there be a mold change? But that's what they charge for. You know, it's basically a design fee or a custom fee to do something different. And the nice thing is if you pay for a mold change, then nobody else can use your mold, which is a good thing in terms of hijacking. But I guess the thing is with Alibaba and the difference between people who say, oh my God, I've had a horrible experience, and people that have had a good experience is that you don't look at Alibaba as a place to shop. You look at it as a place to meet people and start a discussion. And the people that are willing to put up with all my questions and everything are people that, you know, I develop a long-term relationship with.
Awesome.
Which is how I was successful even before I went to China. But then actually meeting these people that I had the relationship with and then meeting other suppliers took everything to a whole new level.
Right, which is a really important point, Smack, and we'll get into that here in a minute with John. But other than that, Mandy, I guess your big tip is, like, even if it's adding like a small bonus item, whether it be a carrying case or a small bag for it, that's kind of like your one thing for people to actually, one thing that they can think about adding to a product so that it's differentiated from all their other competitors, right?
Absolutely, especially if you're in something that's highly competitive. I feel like you have to do something different because, as I said, with those batteries and some of the foot files and all the things that I get dozens and dozens of and I still get today, it's unless something stands out, it's lost in the mix.
Right. Okay. Well, thank you so much, Mandy. We really appreciate. And if you want to hang out anytime you feel like you want to chime in, just go ahead and come back on the mic.
Of course, I'm hanging out. I just started this drinking game.
Awesome. Awesome. You should have had two shots by now. We'll crank it up here in a minute as soon as Smack gets on a roll. I think I might have to call her the S word in a bit. But all right. Well, we look forward to having you, Mandy. And let's go ahead and continue going. So, again, we got John on here. He's going to be on in just a second. Before we go on, though, I wanted to say a couple things. First of all, one thing that people have to understand before they even get to Alibaba, I see people make this mistake time and time again. They picked the wrong product. And I think that's where we're going to bring John in because I know he's talked a little bit about sometimes he's picked the wrong product. So both he and I are going to talk about product selection. In case you guys do not know, product selection videos are in the OMG members area. They are my very formula that I use to select products. It's the same formula that I teach even at the mastermind John and I have. It's the same thing that I teach. It's the same thing that I taught Mandy Payne. It's the same thing that I've taught everyone. And it's the same thing that I use on a day-to-day basis. And I feel that it is the single most important reason that I've had so much success with my products on Amazon, because of the fact that the products that I picked initially were very bad because they followed other people's business models. I mean, in fact, I'm just going to say it here. They followed the ASM business model. They did. It didn't work. I had to go to the next thing, which is making up my own model. And once I realized, wait a minute, these products actually work a lot better and they sell a lot better, I felt like, wow, wait a minute, I'm onto something. I'm going to start doing it my way. I don't have to do it the way that the supposed gurus show, because really it wasn't working. So I began using my way, and my way worked, and that's what I teach in here. So those product selection videos are up there. But secondly, and another really important thing that we forget to focus on, luckily we do have a webinar scheduled for Tuesday. That is the whole keyword research phase. And just, I'm super excited about Tuesday night, guys. I can hardly even contain my excitement. And that's because of the fact that on Tuesday night, we are going to have a really huge, huge webinar on our hands here. Not only do we have myself and Smack, we're also going to have Bitler. Bitler's going to be here showing some keyword tactics, brand new ones. We're also going to have James Harbaugh, the creator of Keyword Inspector. And over the weekend, he showed us just an amazing amount of different tips and tricks for his brand new, all new revamped Keyword Inspector. Things that I didn't even realize were on there. In fact, one thing, I'm telling you guys, this is so exciting. I learned one super ninja tactic from James Harbaugh this weekend that is absolutely going to blow your mind, and it's going to be off camera, so you do not want to miss that. But finally, I will have the guy that I consider to be the absolute one of the smartest Amazon marketers. He's one of my very close friends. He's completely underground. He doesn't even like people to know his name. And in fact, this is a guy that I've masterminded with for almost 2 years now. And he is what I consider to be the number one expert on keywords and keyword research. And he will be here. And the only thing I'm going to tell you guys is he's going to go by the name of the Heisenberg. I call him the Heisenberg of Amazon because he's just so lethal. I mean, he really should be illegal. And he'll be on here on Tuesday night, which is a super surprise. He's done no other interviews, nothing else, but he's ranked probably what I consider to be the most amount of keywords number one on Amazon that I've ever seen anybody rank. He's absolutely amazing. He will be on here answering your questions, talking about some of his keyword tactics, and just we're going to really get down and dirty here. So I highly recommend you want to see that, because after you find the right product, which John Gill is going to talk a little bit about that right here in a minute, you're going to want to do the right keyword research, because without it, your product's not going to be found anywhere. So you really need to be here for that event. It's exciting. I am super pumped about it. I've been waiting for this event for a long time. I can't wait to see what I'm going to learn, because every time I hear this guy talk, I learn something new. So again, you do not want to miss that. It's going to be epic. And so without further ado, let's bring on John Gill, who again, another legend here. John, are you there?
Yes, I am, Elizabeth. How are you?
Very awesome. We're super excited to have you here today. I know everybody is pumped about it. And what we want to do here in a minute is talk a little bit about your experience with Alibaba and how it's done for you. So we'll just pretty much start it there. I know that you actually did source your very first product on Alibaba. Can you tell us a little bit about that?
Well, first of all, I'm not used to seeing you in a webinar without your space shuttle headset on. So I'm a little bit thrown off.
I've actually got my space shuttle command microphone now. Look at this.
Look at you moving up in the world. You're like George Jefferson.
I know. I'm like Wheezy and George.
There you go.
If my ankle wasn't so jacked up, I might even do their little dance.
Oh, God. Sorry I brought it up. Sorry to everybody watching.
Are you kidding me? These guys love it. Are you kidding me? Let's get in the OMG way and get some hashtag. Let's do hashtag like loving it. Hashtag loving it. Let's pretend we're at McDonald's. Let's do this. Hashtag loving it. Smack, get in there and hashtag loving it.
Yes, ma'am.
I'm hashtagging myself. Hashtag loving it. See, John, they're all loving it. They're all loving the fact that I was about to do my George and Wheezy dance. They're all pumped about it. You seem to be in the minority, John.
Not the first time. It's not the first time. It's so becoming a trend.
Let's hear about your first product and how it all happened on Alibaba. Let's start there.
Well, I mean, it was a bit of a struggle, to be honest with you, because it was hard communicating with the people that I was reaching out to. You know, at times it would take weeks for them to get back to you, to give you quotes, and the quotes were not always what was being advertised on Alibaba. So in that respect, it was tough. But I did get – I was very fortunate. Eventually, the one product that I really, really wanted and was hoping that they would respond, after a couple of weeks, they finally responded. And I've had a 3-year relationship with that particular vendor. So, no, I take that back. That's a lie. I've had a 3-year relationship with my sales rep, because that vendor turned out to be a real dog, but the sales rep was amazing, and when she went, moved on to another company selling the same products, I stayed with her, and that company's been amazing, and I've been probably with them for 2 years. Didn't meet them on Alibaba, but met my sales rep on Alibaba.
So it's something similar to like what Smack said is you got on Alibaba, you sort of started to create some relationships with, in this case, it was a sales rep, and that further, you kind of like solidified the relationship at some point and eventually moved with that sales rep over to the new manufacturer. Is that right?
That's correct.
So, John, I guess for me, and you heard Mandy here a minute ago, you go on Alibaba, and a lot of times you see the same old shit, right? I mean, what tips do you have for people that go on Alibaba and are looking for a product? It's kind of, you know, people tell them you have to be different, you have to stand out. What kind of things are you doing in order to do that differently? Just talking about Alibaba.
Well, I mean, Alibaba is great when you're starting. When you don't have many options, Alibaba is probably your best option. For me at this stage in my business, I really don't use Alibaba. Alibaba concerns me, but it's a great place for research. And this is what I think what you and I were talking about earlier. What I've realized is there's certain products out there which I have termed as trader products. So in other words, every trader and his brother out there in China, because a lot of them are not manufacturers, they'll position themselves, they'll even tell you that they're manufacturers, but they're not their traders. So that means you'll find 20 guys on Alibaba that are selling the exact same product. So for me, what I've learned the hard way is those are the products I stay away from. And again, what really hit opened my eyes to that was my first trip to the Canton Fair. And it's because I saw 20, 30 booths all selling my products. So the downside to that, and the downside that what I've learned where it can eventually hurt you on Amazon, is that if so many people are selling it, there's so many traders are selling it, then there's so many Amazon sellers that can mimic your product. So getting in there and getting a product and ranking it and doing all the things that we teach or OMG teaches to get you these amazing results, it's not going to be a long period of time before someone's chomping at your heels and selling it for 30, 40, 50% less than you are. So for me, I use Alibaba more so now as a research tool. You know, so if I find a product that I like, and I see if it's all over Alibaba. If it's all over Alibaba, again, that's something that I look at and qualify as a trader product. I lose a little interest. Now, again, it could go deeper than that because there's ways, without getting into too much tactics, is where you could find a product and, like Susan said, maybe make some changes to it and or bundle it with something else. You know, you do your research on Amazon, you find the stuff that's frequently bought with, and you can bundle it, and that's how you can differentiate yourself. But again, it will not take long before somebody is selling the exact same product, exact same size, exact same color, and they're selling it for a hell of a lot less. So for me, Alibaba is a great research tool, but if you're starting out, Alibaba is a great place to start. But again, Where Alibaba can be very, very helpful is if you do the product research. You pick the right product. If you pick the right product, then you can avoid some of those things. And I don't want to get into that part because that's a whole other webinar in itself, and it sounds like you're going to be covering that.
Right. What kind of mistakes early on did you make in the product selection process, John? Was it just picking more or less trader products, or could you go into a little bit more detail about that?
Well, that was the biggest mistake. That was the biggest mistake, was picking trader products, because I was very fortunate, and I was able to rank my products top of page one in a very, very short period of time and was selling the heck out of it, and it didn't take long for the copycats to come and start selling it at a much lower price.
Right, and I know to this day you still have problems with those copycats from those particular products. Luckily, you use a lot of the tactics that we teach here to keep your products up, but still, you've got people that have been copying you for years now in a way, and it's taken you a while to almost recover from that, right?
Well, it's not only that. So here's the interesting thing, and I think this is an important point. My products still rank at the top of page one, but products that I used to sell 80 to 100 a day, I'm now selling 30 to 40 a day. Products that I used to make $22 in profit, I'm now making $10 in profit.
Right, so you've had to lower your price or just adjust things in order to continue to stay at the top, is what you're saying.
Yeah, and to, you know, but because, you know, so many of those copycats came in, it's just, again, it's part of the game. It's just part of the Amazon game.
Right. So what tips do you give people that are brand new, they're starting out, they're starting to use Alibaba? What kind of tips do you give them other than what you just said? Like anything else you can tell them that you would do now?
Absolutely. I mean, I would, knowing what I know now, half the products that I have, I wouldn't be selling. So I've learned the hard way, and it all starts with product research, is researching. And again, this is probably the thing that most people – well, if you remember, Liz, at our last China event when we did the survey, it was the number one thing by far, no close second, of what people wanted to learn, and that was product selection. So what I found with my students as well, it's the biggest challenge that they have. And so – but it, so it's the most important – and it can be the most challenging, but it's also, if you nail it down and you learn how to do it and you spend the time, it's a very tedious and very time consuming process. But if you do that and you find the right products, then you're not going to, it's going to take, you know, take a while before the competition catches up and you get the copycats. But if you're right, going after the quote unquote, as you pointed out, the ASM model, which I think is ancient and doesn't, you know, it's not a good model. Let me just leave it at that. Then you could be all right. You know, if you don't go in that direction, you go in different directions like we do and we teach, you'll be okay.
Right, absolutely. So for beginners out there, John is pretty much saying number one thing, make sure you're picking the right product for starters. And then number two, he's saying, look out, try to find products that don't look like trader products, meaning right now on my screen right here, we've got a silicone spoon. So we want to find a spoon that not everybody and their mother has. At the same time, we sort of have to understand until we start buying our own molds or paying them to mold something, the chances are that at some point, no matter what kind of tactics we're using to rank that particular product, we're still going to get a guy that's going to be almost on our ass in terms of ranking. So we really have to try to differentiate. Differentiation right now is really the key at the point at which you can afford it. But at the same time, one of the things that I see, and I know John is going to agree with this 100% of the time, is people that overanalyze the hell out of everything. And they go to, even if it's one of our masterminds or another masterminds, and 6 months later, they still haven't even picked a product. Would you agree with that, John?
Oh, absolutely. Absolutely. Paralysis by analysis. I mean, that's the thing that stops most people, is you just overanalyze it, and what happens is, and you question yourself, and what it does is you just freeze and you don't do anything. And that's the worst thing you can do, because here's the other thing, and again, this is a little more advanced, is yes, a lot of my products that are highly ranked do not sell the numbers that they used to. They do not make the profit that they used to. But because I have so many damn products, I'm making a hell of a lot more than I was. So again, there's, you know, the fact that somebody's going to copy you is not the end of the world. You know, you can get rich on Amazon being number 2, 3, or 4 in your category. You know, but it's important to you got to start with the first one, but you got to start planning for the second, third, and fourth product.
Right, absolutely. And like John just said, actually, for those of you that are just joining us or joining us late, I was actually hanging out with Bittler all weekend. We were working on some processes for my Amazon business, and I really don't know anybody better at creating processes than the Bittler, so I went and paid him a visit, and we were talking about this exact thing. There are so many products that are out there that are giving people 20 sales a day, and it's so easy to rank them, but we're all kind of like used to this model that we were sold through ASM or something where we should be getting a product that sells 50 to 100 plus units per day. So we're like 20 isn't good enough for us anymore, right? 20 is not good enough. But what I found is, and where I've had a lot of success, is I don't waste a lot of time. Once a product that I have starts selling 20 units a day, I move on to the next product. And that's why I have a lot of products. I have a ton of products that are selling like 20 units a day, which is about the average per product. Every now and then I'll get a lucky one and I'll get one that sells 100. But for the most part, I'll have some that sell 10. All my products sell 20 a day. After they hit 20, I move on. I'm like, 20 a day, fantastic. And that's why once you have a bucket full of those products, collectively you're selling a shit ton. And, you know, when one goes down, the whole ship doesn't go down. Whereas I see a lot of friends that I have that have spent years building one product, and yeah, maybe they sell 200, 300 units a day, but when the ship goes down, they really are hurting because that one product is just, or the couple products, one or two of them go down and they're like, oh my God, what am I going to do? Everything I do is in those products. And so as a result, a lot of people's expectations start off extremely high, and my expectations are sell 20 of that one product and then they sell really well at some point. If they sell better than that, fantastic. If they don't, I still move on. I don't spend a lot of time on building like these gigantic brands, although people do it and they do it well. Like John, you've done a phenomenal job at it, but now you're sort of branching out and jumping into some other categories and stuff like that. So I guess that seems to be like what you're pretty happy with, is having quite a bit of products that are selling 20, 30, 40 units a day, and really realizing that that's probably the best strategy right now, whereas in the past, hundreds could sell of any one particular product. Am I right in thinking that or saying that?
Absolutely. Absolutely. You know, again, if you look at these informational marketers that are selling Amazon, you know, they have to pitch it that way. You know, look at these products. Here's the top 50 products selling Amazon. You know, power banks selling 4,000 units a day. You know, foot files, 1,500 units a day. That's what sells courses. But that's not a smart model, because not everybody's going to get there. The people that are selling units like that, they already have a huge head start. They have big marketing teams. They have branding behind them. They got thousands of reviews. But it still doesn't change the fact that Amazon is a gold mine. It's just doing it smart. It's just doing it smart.
And, you know, now with that being said, I wanted to ask Smack a question here, because Smack, I know I talked to her a lot about my product sourcing model, and there's a couple products that she sourced that, based on the numbers, I mean, she just kind of took a gamble on them. And I know she knows what product I'm talking about, and gamble on this one product that the numbers maybe weren't spectacular, but they were pretty solid and they fit like the product sourcing model that I source with. And Smack, how well is that product doing for you now? Can you talk a little bit about it without revealing, obviously, any details, but how well is that product doing? Tell a little bit about the backstory with the product.
Well, the product is just one. I had a gut feel. I mean, I was walking around. I was lucky enough to be walking around the ASD trade show with Ty last July, who was an expert in teaching me trade shows. God, she knows more than most people have forgotten. And, you know, I was in this one booth looking for, you know, things that were on my list, and I saw this other product. And I sat there and I said, wow. And I'm like, I can't believe it would work. And I don't know if anybody would buy it. And Ty is like, oh, I think this looks good. And I went back to the room and I looked at the numbers and I found that very same product on Amazon, not selling for very much, by a number of different vendors. And I said, you know, I can market that differently. I can package it. I can market it. And I think I can sell it for more. I mean, it was sort of a, you know, sort of a gut. So I ran it through my break-even analysis so I knew I wouldn't lose money. And I went back and arranged with the vendor to get a sample. I brought it home and it was like, oh my God, this really does everything I thought it would do, solves a problem that a lot of people have. And so I, you know, I ordered it and I spent a lot of time on the bells and whistles around it, for marketing. And it ranks at the very top of its category. And it is selling like hotcakes. I'm on my fourth reorder since October. I really guess I need to have more faith in it and start ordering even more of them. But it was, you know, it was just sort of serendipitous because if I had just been looking online for products, looking at numbers, I never would have found this and never would have figured out this was something I wanted to do. I wouldn't have wanted to pay for samples for it. Have it flown in from China, but by doing sourcing in the flesh rather than online, just looking at Alibaba, I found a gem, and I don't know how long it will be there before, you know, the other people that are working on it. I'm now working with the supplier to make a mold change to it so that mine will be distinctive, but it's interesting, and in the meantime, I've had a nice run and made a lot of money from it, so I'm really hoping I find the you know, the next one of those.
You mentioned a couple things that I wanted to touch on. First of all, how many units are you selling that product per day?
Right now, after Christmas?
Yes.
About 35 or 40 at a profit margin of about $16 a piece.
Wow, smack. I think you can afford to buy us all shots of Johnny Walker Black when we see you next time, Smack. That's fantastic, yeah. Actually. So, Smack, one other thing that you mentioned there for people, I think David Mills got a copy of your Smackaroo break-even analysis, and that should be up in the members area already. If it's not, it should be up shortly. How exciting is it? I know you had somebody – actually, it should be up because somebody commented on it, and they were super excited about it. With that being said, let's get in the OMG way and give a hashtag Smack, since she was nice enough to put that together. I mean, it's an awesome tool. I love it. I've been using it. Hashtag Smack in the OMG way. It's just phenomenal. It could literally, if you guys haven't checked it out, you definitely have to get in there and check it out. It's a break-even analysis. And coming from Smack, who is, I call her a bean counter. She's a very good bean counter. And she's taught me a lot about accounting, including her. If you guys haven't seen that video that her and I did, I think it was like almost an hour long, Smack. And that video was just amazing. I learned so much from that video. I literally gave that to my bookkeeper, and it made sense to her now because she'd been trying to figure some things out that I'd done, and it just didn't make sense to her the way I tried to explain it to her, which is the dummy's way to accounting. But with you explaining that all to her in that video, she was just sort of like blown away, and she was excited about that. Everything finally made sense to her. So if you guys have not checked that out, it is the shit, guys. You got to take a look.
Have you posted it, Liz? Because when I looked yesterday, we were still only up to number 16 on the site. So maybe David hasn't gotten it up yet.
The accounting video I don't think is out, but the Smack sheet should be.
But the one thing I'll say about that break-even analysis, I've been using that with my private coaching clients, basically because when people come to me, it's usually because they followed the ASM sourcing model, and they're stuck with products that they're losing money on. And so sitting there and explaining to them exactly why they're losing money on it and what they need to think about before they buy another product, was something that I really felt I needed to do. So I made some modifications to what I've been using for myself and have shared it with people. And hopefully if I can prevent people from making mistakes up front, you know, it needs to be a product that'll sell. There needs to be demand. You need to use all the selection criteria that you and John and Mandy have been talking about. But you also need to be prepared that you might lose your shirt, and therefore having an idea of the amount of money you'll have to have into it is a good thing.
Right. So everybody, you should be really excited for that. SMAC has put a lot of work into that. And as she said before in the last webinar, there's people charging money for some financial some kind of like financial videos or something on how to do things on Amazon. But I think SMAC broke it down even better. I was super pumped to get my hands on that. My bookkeeper was super pumped to get her hands on that. She certainly saved her a lot of headaches. When you work for me, I'll tell you one thing, you get a big fat headache. Just ask John when you work with me. You also get a big fat headache, which brings me back to John again. So John, a couple things that SMAC said that clearly reminded me of you. First and foremost, that is this idea of creating relationships with your suppliers and doing business one-on-one. You, one big thing you've taught me is, like, a lot of times you want to do business face-to-face as opposed to hiding behind the email, hiding behind Skype, hiding behind the internet. Face-to-face is the way they did business in the past, and face-to-face is the way that business should be done now. It has a lot more merit when you do it like that. And second big thing, so I want you to first talk about that. But and second big thing, we'll get into that after you talk to us about your theory of face-to-face business. So tell people more about that. That's one of the big things that I picked up from you.
Well, first of all, I think there's nothing more powerful as it relates to success in business than relationships. Relationships are everything. And you know, the way business was done in the old days and the way, you know, business has been done for many, many years, in most cases, is face-to-face. Now, we're in a unique business where we can do business from a computer. And you can do it. And you can succeed. But for me, being able to get face-to-face with my vendors and or finding new vendors was critical. It was game-changing. And as a result of that, you know, as you know, Liz, you know, from our last event, you know, we've been able to negotiate 67-day terms. We've been able to negotiate partnerships with vendors where they fronted the product, which allowed us to scale a business with no money out of pocket. We've been able to negotiate much lower prices from what we're currently getting. And we were able to, you know, touch and feel to feel out a person and to understand if this is somebody you want to do business with, somebody that you feel that you can trust, it's really hard to do that over Skype. It's really hard to do it. Now, can you do it? And sometimes you roll the dice, yes. But if I had the choice, I'd much rather do it face-to-face. Because, one, I get a feeling of if that's a person I want to do business with, is that somebody I can trust? Because they can also hide behind their keyboard as well, if you're not over there. And by me going face-to-face, where most of my competitors are not willing to do that, that gives me a huge edge. It allows me to build that relationship and allows me to get things that, you know, my competitors are not getting. Like I said, like terms, potential partnerships, better pricing, things of that nature. Because the other thing that I've learned, and this is what the Chinese have shared with me, is the fact that you were willing to go there and meet with them takes a relationship to another level, and they take you more serious as a real business person. That's what they told me, which makes sense. So I hope that answers your question.
Absolutely. Well,
I add one thing?
Sure.
I think it's just human nature. I mean, like you said earlier in the call, you were kidnapped. Well, I was kidnapped by a taxi driver. I don't know what happened to you, but it's just like we fear them, they fear us. And dealing with people on the computer for them has to be as, you know, they don't feel the connection that – it's just human nature. Feeling that connection, meeting people face-to-face helps them too. I mean, they deal with some sleazy Americans. So I just wanted to make that point.
Yeah.
And that's what I found from them.
It's kind of similar to like – when people have like relationships or they meet their girlfriend or boyfriend online, And it's like they're constantly like Skyping or whatever. There's nothing like one-on-one interaction, right? I mean, it's the same thing. You really don't get to know a person until you get to hang out with them in person and get to see what they're like. So Mandy's absolutely right, because I know a lot of people that have said, oh, the Chinese, they always rip me off. They're scumbags or they're shady and things like that. But Mandy's absolutely right. I mean, they're also dealing with some scumbag Americans. So a lot of the time it's really kind of feeling each other out and figuring out, is this guy for real? Because just imagine how many emails they get on a daily basis of someone that's interested in their product. So how many of these people do they actually take serious? They don't know if you're actually that serious until you show you put a little bit more effort in. You show up in China and you meet them at the Canton Fair, they're going to know you're a lot more serious than what another person is just emailing them and asking them constant questions. Same thing as like when you actually buy samples from them, they're going to know you're a little bit more serious than somebody else that doesn't want to buy samples from them. So second question going to John is, with that in mind, there was something else that Smack mentioned that we're kind of heading into here to talk a little bit about is, and that is, we've obviously got this all, like, everybody should know that Alibaba, if you're starting out, the way I like to call sourcing in general and to think about sourcing is it's like progressive sourcing. When you first start out, you really got no choice. You've got to go to Alibaba. That's when you're first starting out. You have a limited budget. We talked about some of the things you can do on the limited budget. You've got to go to Alibaba. You've got to source from Alibaba. It's your best choice to source from. Try to play it safe. Pick vendors that are – let me pull up my screen here and show you guys something. Pick vendors that are at least got a couple of these classifications. I believe it's what is it? Gold. I think they might be gold suppliers. Obviously,
gold, and then it also shows how long they've been on Alibaba, and the longer the better.
Gold, trade assurance, and assessed. I usually look for two out of the three. I want to make sure that they have some of those. You can, of course, break it down and be a little bit more strict with your whatever you want to choose. Sorry about that. I had to get some water. And like Susan said, this one's 5 years, this one's 5 years, this one's 2 years. Make sure they're at least certified with that and then contact them. Always for samples, you're going to have to send them either Western Union or MoneyGram. I usually just Western Union them. If you're going to be sending a lot of different samples, then I recommend a service that actually, and I put it in the actual members area, that will collectively get all your samples and then ship it to you. I believe it's etoc.com. Don't quote me on that. It's on my laptop. The actual bookmark is. I use that service and they grab a bunch of my samples and then send them to me. That will grab, let's say you have 10 samples coming from 10 different suppliers. Smack, if you want to tell this story, this is a great time to tell your story about 10 different samples from 10 different suppliers. I think ETOC would have come in quite handy for you at that time.
Oh, it would have, but I had no idea. I was looking for my second product. Right. And it's a product that's made by a lot of, a lot of different factories. And they all look the same when you look at them on the computer, but they have different quality. So I sampled the same thing from 10 suppliers to pick the supplier that I felt gave me the highest quality. And it was really, they were really different when they came. But then, you know, the cost ranged from $30 to $120 for a sample. So that cost me a lot in terms of sampling it. The one advantage I'll say about going to China, and John talked about how they view you as more credible, I haven't had to pay for samples from the people that I talked to in China. Even one new supplier that's a little thing that they're absorbing, that's not only there's not a sample cost, but there isn't a shipping cost, because they view me as a business person who's serious and they want to win my business, which is a very different headset. That alone, has more than covered the costs of going to China last time, what I'm not spending on samples.
And Matt, can you tell everybody how much you spent on samples that time when you sampled the 10 different samples?
Oh, it wound up being close to $1,000.
Right. So you could hear it here, guys, like that's how much Smack really, like, it just means a lot to her to get all those different samples, and rightfully so. She said she got 10 different samples that all look the same. We got a surprise visitor here. Look, everybody. Look who's here. Say hi.
Hey, guys.
It's Mike. Delivering.
Hi, Mike.
Hey, buddy.
Oh, John. John's on and Susan. Oh,
and
man.
Mandy. Mandy's on there, too.
Mandy Payne?
Yep.
Okay. The one and only.
It's our home week.
This model, Mandy Payne's on here.
Hashtag OMG. hashtag City on Hill. This is awesome. How's the webinar going?
Fantastic. We're talking about smack sampling.
Oh, that's lucky stuff.
Yep.
But to put it in perspective, you know, I have since ordered, I don't know how many of those things I've ordered, probably 10,000 over the past year or so. So you take that $1,000 and amortize it over it, and it's not a big deal. However, if I had known you better, Liz, and known about these sample consolidation services, it probably would have cost me $100 instead of $1,000 to get all those samples. So I still could have compared samples from 10 companies, but much more cost effectively.
Right. So for those of you all that, thank you, Mike. For those of you all that haven't heard of it, I think it's ETEOC. If not, it's in the actual slides for the product sourcing and getting that consolidation service. So I highly recommend that to beginners. But now that we talked about that, I want to go back and talk with John about something else that Smack brought up that's pretty important. And again, this is all about relationships. So we talked about how to best and effectively use Alibaba. We talked about sampling. You definitely want to do that. And finally, when you do your order, that's all covered in the training, but you certainly want to pay by wire transfer. And even if you don't plan on getting quality control or quality inspection, I do recommend you tell them that you're going to get that inspected, and at least they'll be aware of it and they'll possibly do a better job than they don't. But other than that, I do recommend you do get it inspected at some point or start doing that, because you've got really a lot to lose if you don't. My going into the next thing is this idea that Smack talked about. You've got now experience sourcing on Alibaba. Maybe you got a product or two under your belt, but you want to start doing and building relationships with vendors. So one of the very next best places that you hit are trade shows. And again, there's a couple people that are really good at doing trade shows. For one, John, I consider the foremost expert on actually going to the Asian trade shows. He's gone to quite a bit of them. He's gone to the Canton Fair. He's gone to the HKTDC. He's gone to the Asian Expos. In fact, usually when we're in China, he's hitting all those three. I'll be out enjoying pandas, Hong Kong, Disney, Yiwu, and places like that. And John will be at the fairs working his butt off. So I'm usually the one that's taking the groups on excursions. We go boating. We go listening to Chinese opera. We do all sorts of fun stuff like that. As excursions, obviously, we're networking. But John is like an animal. He's just hitting the pavement. He's working his butt off even in between the fairs. And I'm busy holding some pandas or looking at some warriors or looking at the Great Wall of China. And I'm just kidding about that, guys. I don't do any of that crap. I want to go there. I want to go to the Chinese fairs. I want to go to all that. I want to go to make money. I'm in Yiwu. I'm in China. I'm in Guangzhou. I'm at factories. I don't really horse around. It's very little time that I spend horsing around, other than maybe taking the group on. We did do a nice boating adventure where we went on Smack's birthday. It was partly because it was Smack's birthday, so we kind of used that as like a group building exercise. I don't even know if Mandy was there. Mandy, did you go on our boating trip?
It only hurts me a little bit that you forgot, because I was the captain of another boat, and I think we beat you.
It must have been the boat that we left in the dust. I remember clearly now. I saw you in the dust. Yeah, okay. Now I remember. So we were on a mini boating adventure because it was Smack's birthday, but the whole rest of the time we spent building relationships not only with the members of our mastermind. I mean, we were in the bar all hours with our computers, literally talking about products. Smack was there. Mandy was there as well. But I want to get with John here and talk to John about the importance of going to trade shows. I know, like I said, I consider you the foremost expert of all the trade shows in Asia. And it's based with the experience that you have of not only going to the fairs themselves, going to China, but also teaching other people that are doing the Amazon business. And I mean, I'm sure there's people out there that with a lot more experience than you, but not with the experience of selling on Amazon and going to those fairs. And the only other person that I can think of that's almost as experienced with you, but that's with the USA trade shows, also an OMG-er, Ty Nick, who also goes with us to China. And she takes a mini group of people that go with us to China. She actually takes them to Yiwu. So she really gets down and dirty, gets into Yiwu, which reminds me of the Hunger Games, but that's a whole other story. A smack can attest to that. It's like the Hunger Games of China. But John, let's talk a little bit about the Canton Fair and all the fairs you've been to in Asia. What can you say? Can you tell us a little bit about your very first experience going to the Canton Fair, what that felt like?
Wow, there was a couple feelings there. I mean, first of all, it was like being a five-year-old kid going into the Toys R Us down in Times Square, New York, you know, the five-story Toys R Us. It was pretty amazing to see all those products. But at the same time, it was very overwhelming because if you don't know what you're doing, which I didn't my first time, I was just kind of stumbling through, you can waste a lot of time and not be as productive. But after, this I think is my seventh visit coming up in April. So I've kind of nailed it down pretty good. But for me, again, I talk a lot about the power of relationships. And the best way to build those is face-to-face. So I go there pretty much with a shopping list and a plan of what I'm going to be looking for. And in some cases, who I'm going to talk to. There are many cases where, I meet new vendors there because that's the other cool thing. Is by me going to those events, I get a chance to see the new products first. And it gives me a huge jump on the competition. So I'm also at the same time building new relationships. If I think that's cool, unique, that my research tells me will be a huge seller on Amazon or it's a product that's trending, I get the chance to, to strike up that relationship right there on the spot and, can be first to market with a particular product. It also, because there are certain products out there, and I won't name them because I have friends that are selling these and I don't want to hurt them, but there are products out there where page one is covered with the exact same product. It's the exact same one just with a different branding on it. And they sell amazing. They're amazing products. Now here's the challenge. Because there were so many people, it's getting back to what I talked about, selling the same product it became priced for. So this particular product that I'm talking about, everyone on page one is selling the exact same product. Many of them on page one are selling 3,000 units a month, but they're making very little money. So and one of the things that I teach is that if you can find one that's unique, that does the same thing, it's the same product, but it's unique. It's not the same model that others are selling. Then you can pretty much, name your own price. And again, if you use the tactics that we teach, you're gonna get the product ranked, and you're gonna kick everybody's butt because you're giving the consumer an option. You can position yourself as quality. You can position yourself as different and unique and the newest and latest and greatest. Well, here's the problem, especially like with that particular product that I'm thinking of. You're not gonna find the new unique ones on Alibaba. You're gonna find those going to these events, going to these fairs. So that's why for me it was these events were critical to taking my business to the next level.
Right. Awesome. I agree. I can tell you guys the first time I went to China, as I just mentioned, I got out of the actual cab. I mean, I got out of the airport, jumped into the wrong line for the cabs, was taken on a ride where when I got, I had to pay the guy before I left. Obviously, I didn't know anything. I'm a dumb American, right? I gave the money to the guy, and when I got there, the cab driver was, I had already given him $80. He's like, more money, so I don't know exactly what that meant, and got screwed there for about $100-something. Got to my hotel, which probably wasn't the best hotel to stay at. It was supposedly a 5-star hotel. The hotel was pretty rough. The internet was terrible. All these sites were blocked. I couldn't get on Facebook. I couldn't get on Google. I couldn't get on a lot of different stuff. And here I was trying to run my Amazon business from there, and I couldn't get on all these sites. I had no idea what to do. The food was terrible. I went into the Canton Fair. I got a bunch of catalogs, talked to the manufacturers, the factories, didn't really know what I was doing. And finally, when I came back home, I didn't know how to follow up. So pretty much my very first trip to China was a complete waste of time. It was a lesson, a hard lesson learned. I didn't do the right things. My second, third trips were a little bit better, still not all there. It really took me the experience of meeting people and networking with the right people and then going with them to China. Once I started going with them to China, I've had the opportunity. I mean, I go to China with Kevin and Jin Chan, which are just absolute animals on Amazon. There's really no two better people, I mean, other than John, to go to China with, because those two, I mean, it's just such a great feeling to be able to have friends that are more successful than you are, friends that are like become multimillionaires because of Amazon, and friends that you share tips with and you share experiences with. I got to tell everybody a really funny story from one of my Alibaba sourcing nightmares. Again, when you use Alibaba, you want to be really careful. It's a good platform to use, especially for beginners. But one of the times that I actually used Alibaba, I got a product over that was like a cloth product. And when I received it, it came to me and it's just stunk and it smelled horrible. And I was like, man, what the hell am I going to do? I've got 3,000 of these products. They all stink. They all smell. I really didn't have any idea what I was going to do. So I just began to Febreze all of them. So can you picture me Febrezing the shit out of all these products and then laying them all out in my backyard, in my garage, and anywhere there was some air coming in. So I Febrezed the hell out of them, did that. And I'm going to tell you guys exactly what I thought. And I'm sorry if I offend some people. I'm going to do a little bit of cursing here because this is exactly how I felt. Most of y'all that do know me know that when I'm stressed, I curse. So I remember Febrezing 3,000 items, laying them out carefully, and then having to scoop them up, throw them in the dryer, and see if I could get that stench off of them. I thought to myself, I must be the only asshole in the world that's doing this. And I thought that to myself, and I was just so upset and just doing this. It took me days. It might have even taken me a week to do that. And I did that all by myself because at the time, it was one of my very first products. I couldn't afford to get anybody to really help me out. I do remember my mom was helping me out on this one, but I thought that to myself. Well, the first time I met Kevin Chan, he told me a story about an instance where he ordered all this clothes, all these t-shirts, and they all stunk, and he had to Febreze every single one of them. And he thought to himself, I wonder if anyone else out there in the world is having to do this shit. And it's just so funny that somehow the both of us became friends and we actually shared that story with one another. So reason I'm telling you this is that it doesn't matter how carefully you use Alibaba or anything. At some point, if you're in the game, something like that's going to happen. Another guy that told me a very similar story was David Strauss, who was actually one of the guys that went to our mastermind. And it so happened that after he went to our mastermind, one of the tactics that he picked up, he was able to attract a couple multimillion-dollar companies to enlist him for his particular services. They were quite interested in what he had to offer and what he had done so far on Amazon. That's one of the things he learned at this particular mastermind. So when I finally got China, I was able to really change people's lives by giving them – somebody knows David. Chris Cash knows David. David's an animal. He was at OMG Live. I love that guy. He's really cool. So one of the tactics that I was just talking about before I get distracted by the David comment, and I totally forgot what I was going to say, which always happens. So let's go back to John. And John, talk a little bit about your now the way your whole process is in China. Like, I know you told me originally you used to hate going to China. It was just so it was like it felt like a rainy day every day, you know, because there's no sunshine over there. And it was kind of like brutal on you when you originally started going to China. And then after you sort of were able to make these relationships and start going with other people to China, how is the difference now between then and now?
Well, still no picnic. But for me, I used to look at it as it's like going to the dentist. I don't want to go, but I need to. And I think a lot of it was because, you know, early on, I didn't know what I was doing, and it can be, like I said, very overwhelming. And then the second reason, which, again, with your help, I figured out, was I felt the food sucked. That was a huge thing. So you've helped me out in that, finding the right food that with the hotel that we stay at. But that was, you know, for me, was the challenge in the beginning. But, again, it just had a lot to do with the fact that I was on my own, going there, trying to figure it out, and it was something that was completely new. It was something that can be very, very overwhelming when you first go. And so you know, which led to a lot of stress, a lot of wasted time. And that's why in the early days it was, it wasn't my favorite thing to do.
John, I've got to say, I don't think you're hanging out with the right people still. Mandy, how is the cuisine that I took you to have?
We found some pretty good cuisine. I was able to, I didn't lose an ounce. Of course, McDonald's has something to do with that. There's always the fallback McDonald's.
Right. You know, what's kind of funny is I've had food poisoning in China twice, and every time I've gone to China, I've lost at least 10 pounds. This last time when I went back from China, I'd actually gained some weight. It might have been, what is it, Din Tai Fung? What's the name of that place we go to all the time? Anyways, if you guys have a Din Tai Fung in your area, stay away from that place.
That was awesome. We hit that a few times.
We did hit that a few times. I got to say that what we ate in China was absolutely spectacular. I don't think we had one bad meal. Din Tai Fung and Tiger Prawn and all the other places that we actually hit were just absolutely out. The Mandarin Oriental, I can't complain about that place either. That place is an absolute just fantastic hotel. And the hotel that we stay at, that's obviously quite exciting. They actually had, we had a personal chef who made our own separate menu. And he even, I was stunned. He even made me some chicken breast. He was actually absolutely super excited that I was eating the chicken breast because he said nobody else in China ate it. I was perhaps the only person in China that would eat the chicken breast off the chickens. So every day he was so happy to slice me off a piece of that breast. And I got to say, it was quite exciting. So I don't know where you're eating, John, but you were still hanging out with the wrong crowd, buddy.
No, I said early on, I said, now I got it figured out thanks to you.
Okay, great. Yeah, you're right. I still got to take you to a couple different places, but we'll get that taken care of. You didn't get to eat Din Tai Fung. You're going to be in absolute heaven when you have that. So,
You know what? I mean, the food was so good at the Solex, there was really no reason to leave.
Oh,
I mean, them bringing in a special chef just for us, you know, a guy from, where was he from? Australia, right?
Yeah, Chef Ashley. The guy was unbelievable. That guy was, just a phenomenal chef. They made a special menu for us. And you know what was great about the menu, too? The prices were a lot less than the actual prices of the regular menu. So I thought they did just a tremendous job accommodating us. But let me tell you what the most exciting thing about staying at that hotel was. They gave us all our own personal private VPNs, which allowed us to be able to surf on Facebook, Google, YouTube. What else am I missing? But we were able to hit all those sites up, and the connection was really good. I mean, it was just tremendous. Do you remember that, Smack?
Yes, the VPN. But actually, I think that you can, the Solux can be summed up basically by just my experience after I left, because I had moved to a more inexpensive hotel with somebody else, big mistake, and then wound up coming back to the Solux for everything. So I was like living in their lobby, Theo and I were sitting there. And I wanted to go to a factory in Shenzhen, and I went over and they made the reservations for me. Now remember, I was no longer staying there, but they were so worried because I spoke no Chinese and I was heading off on this venture by myself that the assistant concierge came on his day off, picked me up at the Canton Fair, drove me to the train station, got out of the car, walked me up to security, and then pointed exactly where I was going to go and came back that night to pick me up because they were so terrified that, you know, I'd get lost wandering around in China not knowing how to speak the language.
Right.
And because I had been a guest at the hotel. The service at that hotel is incredible. The food was not only safe to eat, it was great. They gave us all our own VPN. Everywhere you turned, they were looking to help you out. Unbelievable.
Right.
I mean, I stayed at the...
Yeah, and going back to just this building relationship thing, the other thing I wanted to point out about the Solux is the fact that initially when we contacted them, we had one of our assistants contact them and start the entire process. But it wasn't until they met John in person and they realized, oh, this is actually a real guy and he's got a real group of people that are here, that they started to sort of, like, they rolled out the red carpet for you, did they not, John?
Absolutely.
And
yeah, it was pretty cool.
Yeah, and now the fact that they know him so well, they've even gone a step further and rolled out the red carpet now because they realize John means business. John is actually doing what he says. He's bringing people here to China. He's not screwing around with us. His emails are always, he always follows up with everything, and he's actually literally brought the people here. And not only that, but the general manager of the hotel, he's met him face to face. And I think they even gave John some gifts after he left. I don't know where my gifts are. I'm thinking John just smuggled them and took them himself, but I didn't get a stinking gift. John, talk to everybody a little bit about your gifts.
Well, let's see. What did I get? I got a really cool power bank, and got a big bottle of Johnny Walker or something, the high-end stuff, which
yeah,
I think
David Strauss, Rob, the Hearn brothers, and I all enjoyed.
Yes.
That was a nice gift.
Yes, it was. That was very kind of them.
Yeah, wow. Interestingly enough, guys, I didn't get anything. So I had to kind of live vicariously through John and all his gifts and stuff. But at least
Liz, you've been hanging with the right people.
Yeah, you know, I kind of went back pretty – somebody here is talking about Din Tai Fung is out of control. I think I hung out with the right people, John. Din Tai Fung was out of control.
Yeah.
I think I hung out with
– want to say, I don't know if people understand how bad of an experience China can be if not done properly. I had spent – before I went to the mastermind with you in October, I had spent a month in China by myself, and I just call it like a survival trip. It was hot. It was miserable. I couldn't find food. I ate McDonald's morning, noon, and night because anything else made me sick. So it was like night and day going with the group and moving around with the group or going by myself and just trying to survive. I mean, literally just trying to make it alive.
Right. And you know what? I think you're absolutely right, Mandy. One other story I wanted to share with some people before I get into start answering some questions and a couple other things is I actually went to China. I went to Yiwu. I actually went with Rav, who was actually a guy that went to our mastermind. Incidentally, now he's actually offering his own mastermind, which is quite shocking to me. But I went with Rav and I had the absolute worst experience because not only did I get food poisoning because of the restaurants he took me to, which is quite surprising since he's native Chinese person that lives in China. I had the absolute worst experience in terms of a hotel and food, but I also came home empty-handed because I didn't have the right sourcing agent. So it's always important to have the right sourcing agent. You want to have somebody that gets shit done, not somebody that just lives in China and talks Chinese. You want to get a person that is going to get stuff done. And that's why I know a couple people I've actually recommended Mandy in terms of being able to do that for you. So if you're serious about that, I highly recommend you do contact her. But don't contact her unless you're dead serious about taking it to the next step, which leads me to the next step. So let's go back over again what we've talked about and then start getting into some questions. So it's something, again, I like to call progressive sourcing. Step one is if you have no experience whatsoever, get on Alibaba, practice sending out some emails, do things like that. Remember, guys, don't be scared to just send an email. Don't be scared to do that. There's so many manufacturers, so many vendors. If you screw up and sound, if you follow the script that I showed you, you should be fine. But if you screw up and you don't know something, no big deal. You go on to the next one. Do it like you're practicing. Do it like you're practicing basketball, like you're practicing whatever else it is you're practicing. Just practice sending email. Practice getting out there and talking to some people. So do that. Send out those emails. Use Alibaba. Progressive sourcing, step two. Now you've used Alibaba. Get into a couple different things. Either start going to trade shows. If you can't go to China, go to some trade shows in the U.S. There's one coming up in Vegas that I know Smack attends. It's called ASD. I was actually supposed to speak there, but because of my schedule, I cannot. Get out there to ASD and or get a sourcing agent. Message somebody like Mandy. Start working with somebody. Outsource that in your entire business. Get rid of you having to do the sourcing. Obviously, you still will. She'll handle the getting of the samples and coordinating with you and all that, and then you'll handle the product selection and that. But that is step two of the sourcing. And step three, if you've done all that, get out to China, start building some relationships, especially if you're going to take this business seriously. And getting out to China is the single most amazing thing that I've ever done to my business. Not only has it helped me form relationships with manufacturers, but it's also helped me form relationships, which are the most important relationships I've ever had in my professional life and my personal life. I've made so many great friends that, I mean, some of them feel like family. I met John in China. Although I didn't meet Smack, I've gone with Smack to China. I've met Kevin and Jen. I met them at an actual mastermind, and then we went to China together. Mandy, I met through actual friends because of networking. And a lot of this was, I did a lot of networking in China, and I have a lot of experience in China, as does John. But as a result of that, we've been able to provide people that are looking to get to that next level in their business the ultimate China sourcing adventure. And that's what I'm going to show you here before we get into some questions. And again, the only reason I'm actually showing you this inside of OMG is that we don't have many spots left. So Mike Long suggested we show this to everybody that is in OMG first because we don't have many spots left here. So I'm just going to talk a little bit about this, and then we're going to jump into asking some questions. But here, the proof is in the pudding. I talk about not only talking the talk, but walking the walk. That's one thing that John and I do. We both are very much involved in the Amazon, not only ranking products, but the product selection, but selling in Amazon in general. You're not going to find a group of more qualified people that have sold on Amazon and have made millions of dollars doing so. Take a look at this page. It's here. I'll go ahead and put, or Smack, if you could put this page in the actual box, I would greatly appreciate that. Take a look at the thread that I started thanking not only OMG guys like Cotton and Mike, but also people that helped out on the trip. Jin Chan, Ty Nichols, Ellie, Smickdal, Mandy, and Rav was also there, as I mentioned. And take a look at this thread, how I thanked everybody that went there. We had a guy by the name of Michael Weir. I had never met him before. Let me just say, Michael had me taking notes at my own mastermind. I was absolutely blown away by what he shared. He literally shared with us a tactic that for him, it added $250,000 worth of sales in December. And so what we went ahead and did with that is we took that a step further. Maybe John can come on and talk a little bit about that particular tactic. We actually had a very, really nice piece of proprietary software built that is able to execute that tactic. Didn't we not, John? Can you talk a little bit about what that does?
Well, the software that we have that's going to be offered to our attendees, well, one of the softwares, is we refer to it as a lightning deal software. So, you know, lightning deals, for those who aren't familiar, usually only for vendors. And during the holidays, Amazon will offer it to certain sellers, and then you have to go through an approval process, and they may or may not approve you. But it's the Amazon lightning deals, it's just it's a discounted deal. They do it for 4 hours. And as of an ex-vendor, I'm not a vendor anymore, and I don't recommend it to anybody, you can sell a lot in a very short period of time. So what we did is we have a software where you could – what it does is it scrapes your Amazon database of all the sales that you have had, and you can reach out to – and this is all within Amazon's terms of service, so it's there's nothing that's going to get you jammed up with Amazon. You can reach out with the push of a button to all the people that have purchased from you, and that can be based on a particular product that they bought, and you can either offer to them the same product to them again at a discount. Let's say it's a continuity product, you know, a supplement, a skin cream or something like that. You offer them another one for a discount, or you can cross-sell them on a product that that would probably appeal to someone who bought the first product that could buy the other. So it allows you, I mean, the great thing with e-commerce is, you know, you always hear the power of a list. Well, Amazon, you have an amazing list, and it's just hard to access it. Amazon doesn't make it easy for you to access it. So this allows you to access your list and to sell them on additional products or resell them the same product either at a discount or not. So it's an amazing tool. And again, I have a lot of experience with the lightning deals, and they're really, really good. You can sell a lot of products in a very, very short period of time. It helps give you a nice little rank boost. So this tool that we developed will do the same thing. So that you know, that's not something that's going to be for sale. It's only going to be for those who attend our event.
Awesome, John. I am pumped. definitely pumped about that. Also, another piece of software that I'm not going to really get into the major details about it, but I just promise you it is the most powerful scraper available to scrape potential products on Amazon.com. It's absolutely amazing. I used it all weekend. I tested it out. It is just going to blow people's minds. And it's not available anywhere except for a $100,000 tool. So if you got an extra $100,000, you can get that actual scraper. But if not, the only way you can get it is by attending this particular event. So a couple other things. We have some really just out of this world speakers ready to come on this time around. We're going to have a couple people that make on their own $1 million a month that will be speaking at this event. And again, they talk about really tactics that you can execute immediately. They're tactics that anyone can use in their business. They're people that spoke at the last event. And like I said, I was actually taking notes at that event. I was taking notes and I was also kicking myself because when they first started talking, I was like, okay, I kind of know that already. And I didn't have a notebook. So I was like scrambling like crazy, trying to get a notebook so I could take these notes. I had to pull them aside at the end of it and say, hey, do you think you could help me one on this? Because I was too busy thinking about what I was going to say when I went up there again and planning it out. And so it was kind of like, it was just absolutely just blew me away because here I thought I had heard everything. And when Michael Weir and Jin Chan got up there, I was like, oh, Jesus. Like, I didn't realize I was going to need a notebook at my own event. So it was absolutely just, it just blew me away. And this time, it's going to be no different. We've got some really huge names coming out for this one. And some of you might actually even get to meet the Heisenberg of Amazon. He might actually make an appearance. I talked to him over the weekend, and he said he might just come out. So I'm truly excited about that. With that being said, like I said, not only do we talk the talk, but we walk the walk. If you have time, just take a look at what some of these attendees said. It was absolutely just mind-blowing. We got David Strauss in here, Peter Swanson, the British trio. Those guys were absolutely out of this world. Kevin was there. Of course, Mandy. Michelle was there. Ken Dunn, who's an OMG-er. Susan Hokama, which I see here. Tyler Davis was there. He was a lot of fun. And Brenda, I think Brenda's coming again, isn't she, John?
Yep, Brenda signed up.
Fantastic. Brenda will be there again. Ty, of course, will be there. She'll probably be ready to take a group to Iwu as well. So if you haven't been able to meet Ty in person, she is just a ball of energy. She sources everywhere she possibly can. She will definitely be there. Uday and Einers and all those other guys were all there. And again, some of the people that have actually been at the event and or had some success from just meeting both John and I, you can see their some of their earnings reports. So real quickly, we're just going to get into, here are some of the testimonials we have, but what does this all include? And then if you need more information, you can always just Facebook message John or I. Or John, I don't know if you want to give some people your email in case they do want to actually talk to you.
Yeah, you want to type it in there?
Sure, let me go ahead and type it in here. I'll type it in here at the end. I probably need to make sure I typed it right. Smack, do you have his email handy so you can put in there? So while Smack figures that out, let me just talk about what he's getting.
Doesn't John have his own email?
Oh, he can type it in the message box, John. Yeah, you can.
Yeah, rather than me looking it up.
Yeah.
I will do that.
Great. So what you're going to get here, guys, is again, you're going to get a pretty much almost a first class adventure. We're going to show you everything step by step. You don't need to worry about what kind of badges you need to get, your visa, any of that. We will take you through our step by step guide. The only thing that's not included here is hotel and airfare. The cost of this event is two payments of $5,000, all held in China. Unfortunately, since we cannot bring China to you, we have to take you to China, or else this would be something that we would very gladly teach inside of OMG. But this is a 100% true first-class China experience. Again, this is not a trip that's going to give you sightseeing and or things like that. I know you feel really strongly about that, John. Do you want to talk a little bit about what this includes, actually? I think you actually describe it a little better than I do. So why don't you go ahead and kind of explain to everybody what this all entails and what they get. Because like I said, I think you do this a heck of a lot better than I do. I know what I'm good at and I know what I'm bad at. And I know that you're better at this than I am.
Well, you know what? I think, not that I'm better at it, I think I'm just very, very passionate about this. Not that you're not. And I think, you know, to take a few steps back and how this whole thing originated, this was not something that you and I planned on doing. It was something that a lot of people were asking us to do. And I think that's an important point because this is not our business. We're not in the mastermind business. You and I, Liz, and Susan and Mandy and people like that, and the people that are coming to the event, these are full-time, hardcore Amazon sellers. People who are kicking ass and taking names, doing some of which, most of which, doing seven figures a month in sales. You know, real Amazon sellers, not information marketers that are amazing marketers but do very little and know very little on Amazon. These are real sellers that's what they do day and night. So, you know, again, how this originated is people were coming to us, but when we decided, all right, we'll do this, you know, I don't know if you remember this conversation, but you and I talked about it. It's like, okay, if we're going to do this, how can we create tremendous value? You know, and we both agreed we did not want to do this if we could not create amazing value. So both of us have been very fortunate to have spoken at many other events. And the one takeaway I could say is that, you know, being at these events as a speaker, and also, you know, I'm always, you know, trying to learn from, you know, from anyone or everyone, is I also attended the event. So I would just not speak. I would also sit and listen and see what I could pick up. And unfortunately, I can't really say that I ever walked away from one of these events where I learned something that I could apply to my business that was going to make a difference, and or it was stuff that was just way too high level, and I and the people that were in the room were not at a point in their business where they could apply that stuff. So what we decided to do is that we were only going to teach the things, the systems, the tactics, the secrets that you and I and the others that are speaking, that they use in their business every day that gets results. We're not going to teach theory. We're not going to teach BS. This is not going to be a pitch fest. We're not looking to sell anything else there. This is serious, hardcore Amazon selling, and this is only for people who are super serious about growing their business and taking their business to the next level. You know, and I think what you touched on, which, again, is something that I'm really passionate about, is that we're not going to go see the Great Wall of China. We're not going to see the Terracotta Museum. We're not going to play with pandas. We're not going to play with monkeys. We're not going to do any BS. If you're looking for a vacation, knock yourself out. Go on your own vacation. This is all about making money, growing your business, and making money. It's what we're serious about. It's what we're the value that we're trying to create, and it's the people we surround ourselves with. Now, again, you know, I say, oh, there's not going to be any fun and games. The fun and games is the people that are there. I mean, I had a blast hanging out with people. Now that leads to the other point, is the one takeaway that I can say from all those events that was a huge value was the networking. The networking was always huge. You know, there were people that I met at these events that have equated to millions of dollars in my pocket. You know, so that was something else that we decided that we wanted to do, is that we wanted to make sure that we surrounded our group with some very, very successful, but real, you know, Amazon sellers, but the people that were also very, very good people, people that we wanted to hang out with, people that we wanted to learn from. And some of these are the people that I met at these other events that I built these relationships with that were very kind and loving and open and sharing. And I built, you know, these amazing friendships with, and that we continue to collaborate years later. That's been a huge benefit. So we wanted to do the double whammy. We wanted to give amazing content that somebody in the Amazon business could apply to their business that night after, you know, the day of our event. They can apply it that night, and it's going to make a difference. You know, so things that will change your business, that will be a game changer, and not only that, to surround you with the most amazing people that you can network with and build relationships with. And that, for me, and, you know, from the people that attended our event, they said was the biggest takeaway. You know, that's why everybody's told us that this was the best event that they ever attended. You know, and again, it's real sellers. It's people that are, you know, that work day and night in Amazon. And it's also people that have been to China, that have been face-to-face, belly-to-belly with the Chinese negotiating deals, not people who their claim is, I've sourced from China, or that I live in China. That's not the qualifications of the people that will be participating and speaking and networking at our event. So I hope I covered what...
Right. You did, John. But one more question I have for you before I get a bit more into the details here. And I'm actually trying to find a post which I thought it just made me realize, like, what we did in China. Obviously, you got some spam on here on my page. That's not my Pandora bracelet. But while you answer this question, I'll look for this actual, it was a comment left by Theo where it really, like, after he made that comment, I was just like blown away by, first of all, him making the comment, but it kind of sums up how we felt we wanted to bring a tremendous amount of value to this trip. And I felt we did so. And when I got this quote from, I think I even maybe like teared up a little bit because I felt like, wow, for somebody to actually have told me that, I was just blown. And it blew me out of this world to actually have somebody make the comment. But if I can't find it, I'll share it with everybody. But
Liz, you passed it. It was the video of Mate. I saw you pass it. Theo's comment was in there.
Oh, okay. Jesus. Oh, I think it's in another spot. Let me find it there. But no, Theo actually made another comment. So maybe he made two great ones and I haven't even actually seen them. So I'm going to pull both of those up while you answer this question, John. But my question to you is, okay, I see, and I know a lot of people are going to ask this question. That's why I'm actually going to bring it up to you. I know a lot of people are going to say, okay, well, you know, I see that there's not only your event, but, you know, ASM is now offering one and Paul Sinclair's group is offering one. What makes me want to choose? Why should I choose your event over those other two events? What's the difference with your event and why should I choose it?
Liz, can I just say one thing?
Sure,
go ahead. The ASM event is being run by someone who was a student at your event last time.
Okay.
That to me speaks that to me says something right there.
Right.
And I want to say something too. When I talked about that trip that I took prior to the event with you, the one where I called it my survival trip, I was actually escorted by one of the people who's doing this ASM event, who was also a student at your event. And it was pretty unproductive. So I felt like I taught him more than he taught me. And I don't want to, I mean, I'm not going to talk out of school. That's the nastiest thing I'm going to say today.
Okay. Thank you very much for that, Mandy and Smack. And now, John, what is your take?
Well, that's a loaded question. You know what? I think to simplify it is just look at the qualifications of those who are putting on the event. You know, like I mentioned, information marketers or people who their qualifications are that they sourced from China or they live in China, but don't have a successful Amazon business versus those who've been to China, have, done all the dirty work in China, the blood, sweat, and tears, learned the process, built the relationships, and that are, you know, have huge Amazon businesses. I think that, you know, just focus on the qualifications of those. And the other thing too is, like I said, you know, this is not going to be a sightseeing vacation. You know, my philosophy is, you know what, let's learn how to build a huge Amazon business. Let's, you know, kick some serious ass, make some serious money, and then go on your own vacation and have a great time with your family. Right now, the opportunity is now. This is, I say this all the time, this is the gold rush of our generation, this Amazon opportunity. Let's get in now. Let's stake our claim. Let's build a super big business and make a lot of money. And so that's why, you know, for me, I'm not looking to mess around. We're not going to be dicking around. We're going to get in there, and it's going to be hardcore training. And, again, things that you can apply to your business right away that will make a difference in your business.
Right. Thank you for that, guys. I could not find the comment from Theo anywhere, and I think John said it was here somewhere, but might be under the replies. Basically, Theo said that it was the best trip he'd ever had in his whole life. So I thought, like, I was blown away by that because I was thinking in my head, like, I had told everybody how torturous China was for me for three or four times. And then here came Theo on his very first trip, and he said, this is the most amazing trip I've ever had. To me, that was the absolute best comment I could ever receive in my entire life, pretty much. So I was totally pumped about that. But it just made my day. It probably made more than my day. I was just so absolutely just blown away by the fact that somebody would say that, and I wasn't able to create that much value for them, not only personally, but professionally, because his actual business took off, if I'm not mistaken, after he ran out of stock on something. He took off after that using one of the tactics we talked about. So with that being said, you heard John's take, you heard Manny's take, you heard Susan's take. I just wanted to go over a couple of the details. And then if you need anything, I would highly recommend to give John an email. He will get on the phone with you one-on-one to make sure, first of all, you're even qualified to go on this trip. We want to take people that are very serious. We want to take people that want to learn how to make money and that are really serious about their business. So with that being said, it is two payments of $5,000. They can be spread out. One is due 30 days before the event, which will be held the 14th through 17th in Guangzhou. We will attend the Canton Fair. First of all, we will have 2 days of hardcore in-classroom style boot camp days, and we'll have one night of networking. When will that be? The 13th, when we all get there, we'll have some networking in the evening. The 14th and 15th, we'll be in the classroom doing pretty much in the classroom all day, learning from some of the very top multi-million dollar sellers on Amazon, most making as much as $1 million in a month. So we'll be in the classroom those 2 days. And the 16th and 17th, we'll be out on the floor at the Canton Fair, showing you how to navigate the fair, what to ask, what to look for, how to negotiate deals, how to create these relationships. And on those evenings, every single evening, we will be in this really cool bar area that the Solux has. They have some tables. If you actually take a look at some of the pictures I posted on my Facebook page, you will see that they had these tables set up. We would be in the bar with our laptops. We would be talking about product opportunities. We would be talking about business. We'd be creating really solid lifelong friendships that we have to this day. I mean, I keep in contact with some of these guys on a daily basis. What's really interesting, guys, is the fact that I tell you all, I can't get to all my Facebook messages. I have a ridiculous amount of Facebook messages, but anytime I see one from Theo or David or Smack or Mandy, ask them how quickly I get back to them. And that's because, unfortunately, I have time for just my friends, and I want to help as many people as I can. That's why I do this. But, I mean, it's just difficult for me to keep up with hundreds of messages. But the people that I've created these relationships with on these networking events that we have during this mastermind are people that I answer questions for. And that's just because of the fact that I know them. They made the effort to come out and meet me. They made the effort to come out and make their business better. I know they're serious about this business, and they don't want to waste my time. And that's why I answer them. Ask Smack, how long does it take me to answer you?
Depends on what time of day it is, Liz.
Smack. Susan McDowell. Do we have to bring the shot glasses out here? Mandy,
you're pretty responsive.
Mandy, how quickly do I answer you?
Well, you answer me faster than you answer McDowell, and that makes me happy.
Very much.
How do you know that, Mandy?
I keep track. She only answers Jen faster than me.
Oh, so you go get there Facebook someday. Account and you log the times? I mean, I know.
As Liz said, I'm very busy, and that's what I'm busy doing, stalking you, McDowell.
Okay, let's not go there.
Here, guys, you heard me. I answer incredibly fast. So details are, again, $5,000 payment dollar due now. Talk to John about that $5,000 30 days before the event. The total for the trip is $10,000. As I said before, with just one of these techniques, you will get all your money back if you use it. Take action. That's the key. You really have to take action on what we teach there. We teach an incredible amount of tactics, and we drive deep into the basics. Again, these are things that you cannot learn here in the USA. You have to go over to China to learn them. If not, I would bring them straight to you inside of OMG. A couple other things. You are responsible for your own hotel and airfare, but we have negotiated some of the very best prices with a fantastic hotel that is a five-star experience. They set up our very own private VPN, which is just amazing. They do pickups at the airport, which, again, is awesome. You don't have to worry about getting ripped off by a cab. And they also have a lot of other wonderful services like massages and stuff like that. And we usually do, like, a lot of group massages. So we know the best places to go to massage-wise, eating-wise, the chef, he caters to vegans as well. I know we had a couple vegans on the trip. They did a fantastic job. Even Smack was eating vegan because the cuisine was just that fantastic. So she joined the vegans on a couple dinners. It was just out of this world. Absolutely amazing experience. You will get to see, like I said, some of the very top Amazon sellers present what they are working on. And these are things that I haven't seen covered anywhere else. As I told you, I was taking notes. I took pages and pages of notes when Michael Weir was talking, when Jin Chan was talking. And I learned so much from all the other attendees. We actually had a contest there. So I want to talk a little bit about the contest and then get into the questions. But we had a contest called The Smartest Marketer, which we are still about to go into the voting process. But one guy blew us absolutely out of this world. We felt compelled to give him a free mastermind because of the fact that what he shared with us was just, it was absolutely revolutionary to everyone's business there. He actually gave everybody a piece of software, and it's the software that you will also get, but he unanimously won the next trip, which incidentally, we are having another mastermind in Cabo. So if you don't want to go all the way up to China, contact John and ask him about Cabo. Cabo is another great experience, and you don't have to go as far. Cabo covers a little bit more of marketing tactics. But with that being said, this guy blew everybody out of the water, and incidentally, he was like not one of the only people that shared. Almost everybody that went there shared some really great, amazing tips that I haven't heard discussed anywhere else. So a lot of those tactics I still haven't even been able to implement. I've only implemented a couple things that I learned from that mastermind, yet I've made a ton of money doing so. So again, if it's something that you want to know more about, contact John. He will be more than happy to answer all your questions or send me a Facebook message. I am trying to catch up with those guys, I promise. And if you need anything else, just ask away. You can ask away here in the actual questions, or you can ask me, send me a message through Facebook, contact John through email. And again, thank you so much for listening to all that, John. Thank you for joining us. Hopefully you stay for a couple questions.
Absolutely.
Same thing with you, Mandy, and Smack. Let's get into those questions now. I'll pass them on to John and Mandy if they're still here. So we've got here. Hello, Liz. I consider selling through Amazon, arrange from the Netherlands, and operate through a warehouse company in America. In your webinar January 10th, you mentioned the outsourcing of sending and packaging your products by warehousing, letting them ship to Amazon for you. Kevin and Jin are riversourcelogistics.com. That is the service that I use. I don't recommend anything that I don't use. So I use Riversource Logistics. Bittler, who will be on the webinar on Tuesday on keyword research, he uses Riversource Logistics. I absolutely love them because they are Amazon sellers, very successful Amazon sellers that offer a fantastic service. And the fact that I have a good relationship with them, if I ever have a problem, I pick up the phone and I figure it out. Same thing with Bittler. He absolutely loves them. It's something that I highly recommend. OMG Way. We are in the OMG Way. Let's get in the OMG Way. I forgot about that freaking forum here. Let's get in the OMG Way and let's say hashtag China. If you guys are excited about China and sourcing there, if we get a hashtag China going, that'd be awesome. Again, China is one of many places you can actually source from. You don't have to start there, but at some point, if you're going to want to grow a nice big business, China is going to be the place that you go to. So again, it's all about networking and building relationships with the right people, not info marketers that sell products who aren't even selling on Amazon. Again, John and I are deep in the trenches. Smack is in the trenches. Even Mandy has joined us in the trenches. And we're all Amazon sellers. What a surprise. Next question. What item category do you advise me to double on retail arbitrage? Go into the categories that you are automatically accepted for. We got home, kitchen, sports, outdoors. What else? We have books. Anything else? Electronics, garden. Those are the only ones I can think off the top of my head. Start with those. How do you get rid of the $3.99 shipping fee on Amazon? I'm not sure what fee you're talking about, Tommy, but I'm guessing I don't actually know what fee that is. Can you explain more about how we get codes for labels to send into FBA? Helen, the codes are called an FN SKU. FN SKU gets printed out once you scan it into Amazon or type it in manually. So you'll need an FN SKU. If you're talking about UPC labels, I get mine on eBay, which Smack laughed about. Smack and John, do you want to share where you get your UPCs from?
I buy them online. There's, you know, I don't know the name of the service, but you can just Google cheap UPCs and there's many resources that you can buy them online.
I think mine is actually called cheap UPC barcodes. And then you get the number, and then there's a, I think it's called Terry Burton's barcode generator that will actually generate them with an EPS file so you can send them to your graphics designer and have them integrated in the packaging.
Okay, awesome. Here's another question. Is pick and pack and weight handling fees the same thing as FBA fulfillment fees? The way you find out, in the example I gave on one of the training videos, I went over the hoverboard bag, and I just pick any single one of these. Put your price that you're going to decide to sell this for, and then hit calculate. These fees right here, Amazon referral fee is the fee that you're paying Amazon for selling the product. And pick and pack and order handling, these are all based on the shipping of the product here. So all this combined, just add it up on your calculator. A 12359 is here, something. 373 is the fulfillment, and $2 is there, so it's 568 altogether. So those are the fees. Definitely, Benny, I hope I've been a category 10. If not, I guarantee on Tuesday I'm going to be out of this. I'm going to be off the chart on Tuesday, I'm telling you. How much do you usually spend on Amazon ads to test the keyword to determine if it's going to be profitable? I usually leave it running for at least a month, Moses. And again, we will have the Heisenberg of Amazon on Tuesday. That is a great question to ask him, but I think he's going to tell you the same thing. In fact, I think he usually likes to run it 2 to 3 months tops, but I usually like to leave it at least a month. Are FBA fulfillment fees included when showing using Profit Bandit? It depends. If you're talking about these fees, yes, they are, but you have to make sure it's checked off. Have you ever sold any items from a closed down Starbucks? Yes, James. I know plenty of people that sell those Starbucks City mugs. So those sell quite well. Hello, I have a problem with my Facebook being locked. Okay, I'm sorry. You probably need to send in the ID. Mike Long just had the same exact thing. Smack, stay off Smack. That's a great tip from Corey. You're the man, Corey. Here we go. Jacob, I'm wondering, how do you get number one position using sponsored ads? My listing's optimized with the keywords, however, unable to get that position. Really, Amazon is not using all of my 15 for both campaigns. Do you want to take that one, John, since you're pretty good at sponsored ads?
So is the question, you know, how does their ad appear first?
Yes. How does it appear first spot?
It's usually your bid. You know, most likely you're not bidding enough, and that's why you're not appearing up at the top.
Okay, great. I don't know why I have an echo now.
There's some ninja tactics that help you get there, but those will be discussed in China.
Okay, can you spend it? Can I spend it? Okay. Is that a trick question? So here we have another question. Somebody add like a different mic. Cricket. Okay, I guess not. Sorry. I'm not sure if someone had mic. Let me figure it out here. Smack. Let me mute. Smack. Let me see if I have an echo. Okay, it's not Smack. Do we have an echo? It might have been John. Okay, do we have an echo now? Okay, John, I'm going to mute. I'm going to mute someone and answer the question. Okay, so John was getting that echo. So when we need him, we'll unmute him. Here we go. Liz, your coursework is amazingly awesome. Question, if you find a product that has good numbers, but a lot of other people are already doing FBA in it, would you still move forward? How many other sales would it take to make you pass? LC, what I would do is kind of use some of the tips that were given on this webinar. not, it's not necessarily a product to shy away from if you can somehow differentiate. Mandy gave a couple good tips on that. So I would recommend looking at that. There's going to be a lot of actual categories where you get into and you have a lot of competition. A lot of times that's a very healthy thing. Look at the Jungle Scout numbers. Make sure that at least the top 10 are making some good money before you make that decision to move forward. But clearly try to figure out a way to differentiate that product as much as you can. Here's Corey saying he goes to the stationery show and toy show in Hong Kong. Enormous. Absolutely, Corey. It's the bomb going down there. Eric, we go to Guangzhou. I've been to Shenzhen. I've been to Ningbo. I've been to Guangdong, Yiwu, all sorts of places. I've been just some places that I don't even know what they're called. I just get in a car and they drive me there. And I'm in rural China with sheep and all sorts of different animals. Some animals I've never even seen before. I'm just kidding about that, of course. Liz, at one point you mentioned that all the different Amazon business models could be scaled infinitely, and that really surprised me because I was thinking of the different models as a progression. Would you say that someone can do six figures per month just from retail arbitrage? Absolutely. I've done it. Ty Nick has done it. A bunch of people have actually done it. It's very easy to do so. It's going to take a lot of work and probably quite a bit of manpower, but it can very easily be done. Liz, do you ask your suppliers for AQL standard when you order, and what is the minimum you accept? Mandy, do you want to answer that? Because Mandy does a lot of my sourcing now. When I first started, I did not. I still don't actually think to a certain degree we ask that. We just have an agent that actually checks on that.
Okay, would you ask the question again? Because you broke it. It broke up when you were asking it, but I'd be happy to make up an answer.
Do you ask your suppliers for an AQL standard when you order, and what is the minimum you accept?
Well, no, I can't answer that. It varies by client and it varies by supplier.
Okay, I don't necessarily ask that, Moses. I have not asked that. I usually just have, like, my agent check on this stuff. I know there's a lot of people that really get into, like, the quality stuff. Like, they're really, it's like, there's even a whole blog dedicated to it, but I've never gotten, like, that technical where I ask them for any of that stuff. I just basically let them know, look, somebody's going to actually be inspecting the actual product and at some point during the entire process as well as at the end of it. So I don't get that technical into it. I wish I remembered the name of that blog because it was some interesting reading, but I never usually am that strict with the supplier because, again, sometimes a lot of times that scares them off and they're like, you know, who does this person think they are? And at some point, like, my whole point is trying to create, like, a relationship. Maybe we can ask John to see if he actually does anything like that, but I don't think he does either. John, can you answer that question? Have you done anything like that?
No, I haven't.
Okay, so, yeah, I haven't either. Okay, Smack. So I haven't either. Smack. I don't think Smack's there anymore.
No, I'm here. It was just breaking up for me. Could you repeat the question?
Sure. Do you ask your suppliers for an AQL standard when you order, and what is the minimum you accept?
I have no idea what an AQL standard is.
Okay, so Moses, nobody does that. Sorry about that. I tell them that I'm going to have an agent inspect that, and that's pretty much it. I don't really get into that many details about it. Liz, what do you get involved in a pricing war situation with other? What do you do if you get involved in a pricing war situation with other FBA sellers? Do you just stand your ground and wait, or do you keep dropping the price? I think this is a great question for John. Let me bring John back on because he's been in numerous pricing war situations. Did you hear that question, John?
Yeah, can you repeat it again? I want to make sure I understood it. I know it had to do with pricing wars.
What do you do if you get
what do you do if you get in a situation with other FBA sellers?
It depends. I mean, I don't lower my price, you know, because I stand behind my products. And what I do is what I wait for to see is if it affects my sales. You know, what you don't want to do is be stubborn and, well, I'm holding my ground, you know, because my product's the best and, you know, and I'm not going to lower my price because of somebody else. But let the market speak, you know, let the market speak for you. Let them, if you see that your sales start falling into the toilet, then you're going to have to lower your price. So I would not take, you know, no knee-jerk reactions. You see somebody lower their price and then all of a sudden you think you have to. You might not have to. But again, there's just so many variables. It's hard to answer that question. Is yours the exact same? Is yours bundled with something? You know, do you have more reviews? Are you ranked better? There's a lot of variables there, but no, I wouldn't do any knee-jerk reaction. I wouldn't do anything. I would wait to see if it affects your sales. And again, and then you got to make sure, is that why your sales are being affected? Because your competitor lowered their price. Because, you know, there's always going to be somebody having the same or similar product that's lower than you, but it doesn't necessarily affect your sales. You know, one of my original products I was selling at $35.77, and there were others that were selling the exact same product for $9 or less, and I never changed my price, and I still kicked their butts, you know, because I rank better. I positioned my product as quality. So, again, you don't necessarily have to change price.
Awesome. Thank you, John.
Liz, there was a clarification to that question that they were referring to retail arbitrage.
Which question, Smack?
The price war question. The person who asked just clarified, saying that they were concerned about price wars with retail arbitrage.
Okay. Typically what I do, LC, is I have a bottom price that I'm looking to ask for. I never lower my price. I match the low price, because the thing about retail arbitrage that most people do not understand, and it just totally baffles me, is that the way to get the buy box, it's not just price. It's an actual collection of different metrics that Amazon looks at in order to figure out who gets the buy price, the buy box. That includes the seller feedback, the amount of time that it takes you to answer emails, the price itself. It has to be within a certain percentage of the low, and a couple other factors that I don't even quite know. So what people misunderstand is they think that by having the lowest price, you get the buy box, and that's not true. Take a look at a lot of listings. You'll notice that the seller that doesn't even have the lowest price will actually get the buy box. And that's because it's different factors. So what I typically do is I match the price, but to a certain extent, I'm not going to go any lower than that until I see that the price is really dropping. And at that point, I'll just want to get out and even break even if that can be possible. But there are instances where you even lose money on products. What you have to understand is when you see that this particular product is heading towards that direction, just get out. You're better off putting the money that you have left into that product in another product and making that back and some, because you don't want to get stuck with a product that's not going to move at all. It's more important to be able to have that money into a product that's going to move fast and it's going to make you some money. So hopefully that made sense. Smack's last name is McDowell, McDowell. Mandy is not doing Amazon reviews anymore, I don't believe. Do we need our own Bluetooth licenses for private label products, or can we use a manufacturer's license? I don't quite know about Bluetooth products. Let me see. I know John might. I don't dabble in the electronics niche, but let me bring John back on here. Did you hear that question, John?
Yeah, you can use your manufacturer's license on that.
Okay, great. Thank you, John.
You're welcome.
Susan, when you get a mold change, do you have to get an agreement for them not to sell that to anyone else?
I haven't. It's generally accepted practice. I probably should. If this was a big product that I was going into for a long period of time, I probably would. One of the ways I knew that my very first supplier was a good supplier was that when she sent me samples and there was one I liked, and we got to the negotiation point, she then wrote back to me and said, "I'm so sorry, I can't sell you that. It's someone else's mold." And when she said that, I said, this is a company I'm going to do business with for a long time. So there is a thing called a vendor agreement that you can put together all your terms and relationships. But whether or not something's enforceable in China is still up for grabs. So it's general practice. If you buy a mold, it's your mold. But again, it really depends on the relationships, because you're not going to go into China, get a Chinese lawyer, and sue somebody.
Okay, great. So Martin, I think she answered your question as well. How many unique products do you sell at the moment? I think I have 56 of my own Moses and 3,000 of other people's product. And I know John has about the same, but he doesn't sell other people's products. Let's see. Should we do keyword stuffing when we list our products in the title in the bullet? Andre, you're not going to want to miss the webinar on Tuesday. We're going to talk all about that, and I've got the best and brightest that are going to be talking about that, as well as me. I'll chime in there a little bit, but the best and brightest will be handling that question, Andre. Do the dance. You're somebody else that wanted to see my Georgia Wheezy dance. So there you go, John. Who does John use instead of Alibaba? Eric. He uses one-on-one relationships that he makes at trade shows. That's what John does. Let's see. What do you guys think is the most important thing in product sourcing? Let's all go around and answer that. I'm going to answer it really simply, and then I'll put John on the mic, and then we'll get Smack and Manny answer that. I think it's just picking the right product, Eric, not picking a product that's traditionally fantastic because you're going to spend a lot of money promoting that product. So you do not want to pick a product in the top 100. In fact, I stay out of the top couple hundred. I want to pick a product that's not going to have a lot of competition. That's only if I don't have a lot of money. If I have a lot of money in my pocket, then I'll venture into some of the more competitive products. But for beginners, pick a product that's not in the top 100. John, let's get your take.
I'm muted.
Well, my answer, I'm going to be repeating myself here, is relationships. You know, I'm at a point now because of the relationships I've built in China that a lot of times, you know, I get boxes, you know, a couple times a month of samples of new products where all the vendors, I don't even ask anymore. They just send me samples of new stuff, and I just, you know, I just tell them which ones I want. Not only that, if I decide to go into another niche, which I have, you know, it's kind of to some degree, a tight-knit community within China. I just reach out to my vendor and say, hey, I'm looking to get into another product. Who do you know that sells this product that's good that you can refer to me that's not, you know, that's going to do the right thing? So that's what's worked for me.
I'm going to talk a little bit about their answer. But before we go on to them, let me just say one thing about John that I haven't mentioned in this webinar. One of the things and the most important thing that I've actually learned from John is going back to the basics. There's so many of us that are concerned. We buy these fancy courses about how to advertise on Facebook, how to advertise on YouTube, how to advertise on or creative Amazon marketing techniques that people don't even actually execute. They just execute them for the purposes of their webinar. We buy all these courses that tell us all about that, but yet we haven't drilled down the basics. A lot of the basics come from product selection, knowing the back end of Amazon, knowing keyword research, knowing copywriting, knowing how to create images, description, bullets, all the basics. John is big on the basics. So a lot of times you'll hear John answer the same question with the same exact answer, and it's because it's really important. I don't know how many times, and I know John, if he could get on the mic here without having me on the echoing, he would really drill this in. It's all about the basics. I know I've been on a lot of John's coaching calls and come on some of his coaching calls and seen that a lot of his students, when they first come to him, their actual listing is a complete nightmare. That's the very first thing that he fixes. He drills in on the basics. I don't think I know anybody in the world that is better than John at really looking at the basics of what's wrong with your listing and being able to totally revamp it just with making a couple of slight changes on there. So again, guys, it's not really difficult to sell on Amazon, but you need to become an expert at the basics before you get into any type of external traffic, any type of all that magic bullshit that people are selling. You need to drill down into the basics before you get into that stuff. And that's coming from a real Amazon seller, somebody that's making money, talking the talk, and walking the walk. So, Smack, what's your take on that question?
The one most important thing, again, is relationships. I mean, and working with the right people. I mean, I'm just answering a question now about packaging design. One of my suppliers, I told you about the first one saying it's somebody else's mold. That's I knew it was right. But another one, I sent in the packaging design, and he got back to me, and he goes, we can do that, but you're going to save 30% on shipping if we do it this way instead because of how shipping costs are calculated. Now, that doesn't make him any more money. It just, you know, helps the relationship. I have a good relationship, so if there's a problem and things are broken, I get credits from my suppliers. Working with people that you respect and trust and earning their respect and trust is the most important thing in this business in anything that you do.
Fantastic. Thank you, Smack. How about you, Mandy?
Well, ditto on everything that you've all said so far, but I think that from my perspective, the one thing that I would say is, as far as product sourcing and picking a good product is, you know, when you follow your teaching, it's easy to find a lot of juicy products. But when people come to me, a lot of times they've picked a great product, but they've never touched that product. I always suggest get a few of them, try them, play with them, different kinds. You'll find a way to differentiate your product because you'll see flaws or you'll see things where they could be improved. And to me, that's huge. It's just having your hands on those products before you decide to commit to it.
Awesome. Awesome, Andy. Let's go ahead and continue to answer some more questions. We're going to go answering questions for about 20 more minutes. Then we're going to give the ninja tips. I think I have a ninja tip. I think Smack has one. We'll see if John has one. And then we'll stop. I'll let everybody go home except for me. I'll stay on here and finish answering all these questions. So what if you trademark your logo and position your product as a premium brand so that copycats can't really compete with you? Andrew, they're still going to compete with you if the product looks the same. It's just going to be the same product with a different logo. How many unique products? I think I answered that. How do you manage having so many products because you have VAs to manage too? I have no VAs right now. I actually have I have a project manager. I have an operations manager. I have a couple assistants. I have a bookkeeper. So I just have people that are like the leaders of certain departments, and that's how I do it. I don't have any more VAs. Do I consistently sell $500K a month on Amazon? No, I do not, James. I have a lot of other businesses that I'm working on as well. However, starting at towards the end of the year, it will be that and much more based off of the systems I put in place. I spent all last year building my personal brand and building systems, and now we're ready to scale this year, so I'm super excited about that. How important is it to build a brand on Amazon? Very important. You don't want somebody trying to knock off your product, which will happen at some point. So if attending a trade show, it's best to prepare a shopping list of products you've researched. Yes, it is, Anna, but you will always get off track with that, but you want to focus on those and not get too far off track. You want to select a couple other products that you randomly saw and then do your research while you're at the trade show. But you always want to focus on the products that you want to source while you're there. What accounting video is Liz talking about? It's inside the members area. It was just released. I think we did about 3 or 4 of them. The Smack sheet should be in there. If it's not, I'm going to check on that tomorrow and make sure all that gets put up in there. I think I've got 20 videos in there now, and I've got several in production. I will show you Smack's forms on the video, but next webinar I'll bring it up. John does offer coaching. Contact him for that. What trade shows do you feel are the most important to attend? Well, Alicia, it just depends on what kind of budget you have. Obviously, I'm a big proponent of the Canton Fair and any of the Asia ones because that's where I started. But if you want to get your feet wet and do something inside the USA, then ASD, which is in Las Vegas, there's no better show than that that I like to go to. It has a pretty large selection of actual products. Here we go. This is for John. Hey, John, you just mentioned that you can do business with no money out of pocket. Do you mean that you sell on Amazon without having already bought the products? So do you order the product after you sold in Amazon and then your Amazon clients have to wait 3 weeks or so? I don't believe John said that, but let's get him on here. John, how are you?
I'm good. Thanks for asking, Liz. I appreciate that. Now, that came from Mark, didn't it? Mark sent me an email, and I answered him. But just in case anybody else wasn't clear, what I was referring to is while at the Canton Fair and while face-to-face and building these relationships, what I've been able to do is partner with some vendors. So they fronted the product. Therefore, there was no money out of pocket until after the product was sold. Then I paid the vendors for the products.
Awesome. Thank you, John, for
clarifying. Awesome. Thank you, John, for clarifying.
You're welcome.
Where do you find recommended sourcing agents? I use Mandy. Other than that, I've found some on Chinese travel guide sites. I found some at the Canton Fair. There's a lot of different ways that you can find them. But if you need information from Mandy, send her a Facebook message. Again, only send her a Facebook message if you're serious. She doesn't want to work with people that don't know what the heck they want. If you want to find product, then message her. Sample delivery service, Corey. I believe it's ETEOC. It is in the training videos. Susan, where do we find your helpful info in OMG? That's in the Smackaroosh actual module. And there's more coming from her, so that'll be up shortly. What's the best hotel to stay at when visiting the Canton Fair? There's a lot of pretty good hotels. I like the Solux. That's one of my favorites. I also like the Mandarin Oriental. You can't go wrong when you go with the Mandarin Oriental. Do you need someone who knows where to eat? You do need someone. I know all the places to eat. Now I do, at least. Let's see. Din Tai Fung is delicious. Is it safe to invest about a minimum of $500 to $1,000 per product at a trade show? If you start small, Anna, it is $500 to $1,000 is still not a lot for a product unless you're talking about a product that's in the U.S. and that you're getting from a wholesaler or a distributor. Then it's okay to invest that. But really, that's not a lot of money for when you're doing like China or something like that. It's the Solux, S-O-L-U-X-E. Was I mistaken in thinking that John Gill was about to talk about keyword analysis since his hour spent? Yes, you were, MS. Keyword analysis is on Tuesday. And again, it's with Bittler and the Heisenberg of Amazon, as well as we got James Harbaugh, who's the creator of Keyword Inspector. I'm going to show you what I learned over the weekend doing nothing but keyword research. China, the Canton Fair is in Guangzhou. So our pockets should be rather deep. Not necessarily deep. You probably need for your first product about, I would probably recommend about $5,000 with marketing expenses and everything. I'm going to plan for either Vegas or China this year. Law of attraction. Definitely, Anna, we hope to see you at either one. I use the law of attraction all the time. I love Bob Proctor. He is one of my good friends and I can't get enough of that guy. He's absolutely, just hanging out with him is just like amazing. I love to hang out with Bob. He is the bomb. Sorry if this is a dumb question. There is no dumb question, LC. What exactly are you doing at trade shows? Are you sourcing product, forming relationships, both? You are doing both of those, LC. John just talked about it. Smack talked about it. I talked about it. You do all of the above. You do business one-on-one with somebody. It's just the best way to go. Brother-in-law works in Shanghai. I think you should pay him a visit. How can I get more trainings about digital products on Amazon? I saw ones from Jim Utzinger, but it was kind of short. I don't actually sell digital products on Amazon. I think what you're more or less talking about is like Kindle. I don't see why some of these same tactics cannot be used for Kindle. The thing that you have to be careful with is the giveaways are entirely different. So you do have to look at information about that. But pretty much other than that, it's all the same. Ranking a digital product is going to be absolutely the same, but the promotions and things like that are going to be slightly different. Sure, post all your questions, LC. Mastermind groups are paid groups, Annas, but they are not closed groups. You can get into them by just paying. I would somebody, Beth here, Smack, you got somebody that wants to go with you to ASD. You do not have to be vaccinated to go to China. That was a cost. What is cost of airfare and hotel? Hotel is about, I think it's like 200 USD a night, which is pretty darn good for a five-star hotel because all the Chinese hotels, the price goes up during Canton Fair. Airfare, you can get airfare for about $900 to $1,000. That's the way that I went when I first went to China, and it was pretty nuts. I love China. Yeah, it should be available in the future, Eric. The event will be available. We usually go twice a year. We go in April and October. Again, April is filling up, but in October, we do have spots for that. Let's see. What dates for the mastermind? It's April 14th through 17th. Again, if you want further information, give John a holler at his email address. You can stay for phase two, Neil. Phase two, a lot of people stay for phase two. The reason we do it during phase one is because people want to be prepared and ready to go to phase two, and they want to know exactly how to handle vendors, exactly how to handle catalogs, exactly how to handle navigating the Canton Fair, which could be quite overwhelming because when you get there, the size is enormous. It's just unbelievably huge. Just imagine football fields and football fields full of product. It's out of this world. In fact, the first time I went there, I could not believe that there was a palm tree, a gigantic palm tree, and it had lights on it and everything. It was just crazy. Yes, they have vegan food, Charlotte. It's the bomb. Sourcing, where else can I go for sourcing other than Alibaba and trade shows? I live in New York. If you're doing retail arbitrage, stick with that until you build the bankroll to get into China and manufacturing your own products. That's all you got to do. You just got to keep scanning. Scan as many different actual stores as you possibly can. Don't worry about going to China if you're still in that first phase. You can still make money just using that first phase. That's how I started until I had the money to go to China. Here's somebody. I only come to your webinars because your energy is huge. I don't do even Amazon. David, I love you, David. You are the shit. You just fired me up. I mean, I get fired up off of you guys. I got especially fired up last week when Brian's mom kicked his butt. Let's get into the Facebook group and let's still talk about that because I think that's huge. For all those people that are sitting on the sidelines that still haven't even done anything, David, I know you don't even do Amazon, so that's fantastic. I love the fact that you're here. But let's hashtag girl power and remember the story that Bryant told us about his 49-year-old mother who beat him to $1,000 by just scanning. So the guy that asked Chris B, this is exactly what I'm talking about, man. You don't need to go to China. You need to get out to the store and scan. Bryant's 49-year-old mother beat him to $1,000. How badass is that? I mean, I got so fired up just because he did that. I mean, that shows every single person out there. And not just that, we got another person that I haven't talked about. I'll see if I can get her on a webinar. But her 9-year-old son got out there and scanned, and in his first month, he made $1,000, guys. If that's not testimonial to the fact that anybody can do this, I mean, you guys can literally build up your bankroll to at some point go to China with John and I just from getting out there and scanning. I'm literally showing you exactly what you have to do to build these businesses. And the day that we see any single one of you guys, I guarantee you, first of all, I'm going to remember y'all's names. It's going to be like so much fun. I see Susan in here. Susan was on our last trip. Susan was just absolutely awesome. It was a pleasure to have her. Again, I told you we got several people signing up again, but if you cannot afford to go to China, do not worry about it. You will be able to afford it one day as long as you just listen to what I'm telling you. Get out there and scan. Brian's 49-year-old mother did it. Alexis's 9-year-old son did it. So pretty much, guys, if they did it, why aren't you doing it? There's absolutely no reason why you cannot do this. Let's get to the next question. So thank you, David. I appreciate that. How is state sales tax handled when shipping? Eric, you should have a state sales tax certificate in the state that you're actually selling in. But right now, the gray area, and Smack talked about this in the accounting video, which I think is pretty epic. And if that's not out now, it should be out very soon. You technically should be worried about it for any state which you have product in, which is, I think, 17 different Amazon warehouses. When you first start, it's not something to be really hugely concerned with, but again, it's something that you want to consult with your accountant. But with that being said, do not make that a reason for not just getting started in the business. Just get out there and send some stuff in. First, make some money. Sometimes we worry about insignificant things that cause us to sit there in fear and we don't do shit about it. So get out there and just scan, Eric. Don't worry about that. You'll get to it once you make some money. I am having trouble with FBA. Should I use FBA for any amount of items? Yes, Chris. What exactly are you having trouble with? I'll try to help you as much as I can. Post it in here. The shipping fee is under your price when listing a product on Amazon. That means that you're listing it merchant fulfilled, Tommy. You don't want to list it merchant fulfilled. You want to list it FBA. If you haven't been through my retail arbitrage training, look at that so that you can see how to send something in FBA. Can we talk about Amazon ads? Actually, Andres, the videos are coming out very shortly. They should be out, if not at the end of the week, next week. And I've also got Jack Harvell, who I consider one of the foremost experts on Amazon PPC. He will be on here teaching his tactics that he uses for Amazon PPC. So I promise that is going to be exciting. Best trade shows in New York. In my trade show video, Chris, I show where to go to get that information. I believe one of the websites Ty Nick recommended was TSNN.com. Can you speak about packaging? Do manufacturers in China provide packaging? Are they the best option, or is it better to have a third party handle the design and production of packaging? If so, how do you marry the product and the packaging before sending to Amazon? Couple different options for you, Martin, and then we'll have John answer this as well. The way I look at it, when I do a first time order, I usually don't do anything sexy. In fact, some of my packaging is pretty plain. When they offer packaging, I might get a little bit sexy with my graphic artist. She might do a little bit something different. She'll create the packaging. She'll design it. She'll send it to them. I usually go with the manufacturer's packaging first round when they're doing it and they include everything in the price. But you can get fancy and go through a third party. I usually don't do that until I get into subsequent orders. At that point, whoever you're getting the design from will send it to your factory. If you had to order a little bit more, you can negotiate with your factory for them to store extra packaging. But I usually don't do that until several orders down the line. The first order, I just go with the manufacturer, and I don't make it that sexy. Let's bring John on here, and then we can have Smack also answer that question. John, did you hear that question?
John, did you hear that question?
Yeah, no, it was about packaging, correct?
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
Yeah, no, I mean, I do focus a lot on packaging. I think packaging is important. And what I found is having quality packaging, you know, conveys that it's a quality product and I can charge more. The other thing that I found in quality packaging is I have less returns. For whatever reason, I'm not sure. But when I've launched with, you know, just with whatever plain white box or poly bag that the vendor may give you, as opposed to nice quality packaging, the return rate is much, much lower. So I think that, again, it has to do with the fact that people perceive it as a quality product. And it's important for building your brand, if that's your goal.
Awesome. Great. Thank you.
Great. Thank you for that.
Let's hear your take, Smack.
I agree with John 100%. I put a lot of time and effort into my packaging. I like it consistent across my line, which I thought was going to be weird when I'm using different factories to make things, but they're pretty good with that. I do have my supplier has handled my packaging for me. As I said, I've been lucky with my suppliers, so I haven't gone for a third-party packaging person. But I put a lot of thought into the packaging. In one case, my packaging even costs more than what goes in it. But I use high-end stuff because I want when people open it or give it as a gift, I want them to say, wow. And they do. And it definitely affects sales, customer satisfaction, and repeat purchasing. So when I make a decision I'm going to go with a product, I go with a product and I worry about the packaging.
Awesome. Okay. So I wanted to make a point here and then I'm going to answer a couple more questions and then we're going into the ninja tactic. Then we're going to let all these people go home, have some dinner, but I will stay on here like the warrior that I am and answer all these freaking questions just like I promised. The thing that I wanted to point out here, guys, is as you just saw in that answer, there's so many different ways to skin a cat. You can do things my way. You can do things Jack and John and Smacks. I was about to say Jack and Smacks way. John and Smacks way. You can do things so many different ways that at the end of the day, it really doesn't matter. The key is that we're doing stuff. And yeah, we're going to learn. We're going to make some mistakes along the way. We're going to screw shit up. But guess what? At the end of the day, we're taking action. It's imperfect, but it's action. And action causes a reaction. Reaction is sales. We make sales. We sell stuff. We get shit done and we make money on Amazon. We talk the talk and we walk the walk. So sometimes don't worry too much about some of these small things. Just get something out there. You can even have your graphic artist make your packaging look a lot sexier than it actually is. I've never actually had a customer complain about that. Then on subsequent orders, I make it a lot sexier. So the point is take imperfect action and take it. Let's see, next question. I'm going to answer two more questions, and then we're going to get into the ninja tactic. And then, again, I'll be here to answer all the rest of the questions. Where to get scanner to scan books around my house? You get it on your cell phone, Taft. It's called Profit Bandit. It's an app available for $9.99 a month. I highly recommend it. PPC webinar date is the 23rd. That's with Jack Harvell. How do you get approved to sell Disney? I probably wouldn't bother. A lot of Disney is actually approved. You can still sell it. You have to scan it in on your phone, connect to your Amazon account, and it'll tell you whether or not you can sell it. So do that. Okay. To be added to the Facebook group, add me as a friend. I think if you're not in there, email omg@omgmachines.com. Break-even spreadsheet, James, that should be out. very soon. LC, it depends on what the BSR of the product is. Question is, how many FBA sellers is too many? Depends on the BSR of the product. If the BSR is something like 100,000 and there's 100 sellers, that's not a good product. The BSR is 100 and there's 100 sellers, that still might be a good product. It also depends on profit margin. So, okay, guys, thank you so much for joining us. We're going to turn the recording off now and get into the ninja tactics. And we will first start with Smack. I'm going to pause the record button. I will stay on after this and answer as many questions as I possibly can. So thank you for coming.